Welcome to the Standing Committee on Finance meeting for Monday, August 15th. I want to thank Council Sullivan for running last month's council meeting in my absence. And since that meeting, the city lost a true public servant, and in fact, somebody who's the definition of what a public servant should be. Wayne McAllister was a Brockton firefighter, member of the planning board for many years, and an elected member of the Southeastern Regional School Committee, always with a smile on his face and a true gentleman. And I'd like to start with a moment of silence for Wayne. Thank you.
You must indeed.
Madam Clerk?
Mr. Chairman.
Council Rodriguez.
I'd like to make a motion to take one and two collectively.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take items number one and two collectively. All those in favor? Opposed? Collectively, we will take those. Madam Clerk, could you read items one and two?
Order appropriation of $9,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts ordinary revenue fiscal year 2017 to the Council on Aging Personal Services other than overtime to allow the hiring of a full-time staff assistant for the final three quarters of the fiscal year. And order appropriation of $18,000 from unappropriated estimated receipts ordinary revenue fiscal year 2017 to the Council on Aging Personal Services other than overtime to provide funding for an additional part-time staff position in fiscal year 2017. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, and Janice Fitzgerald, Director of the Council on Aging.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
Evening, councilors. So I think this was a correct decision to take these two items up collectively because really to accomplish what everybody wants to accomplish, which is the hiring of a full-time assistant for the council, you need to pass them both. And if you pass them both, we've got the money to hire a full-time position for about three quarters of the year.
Mr. Chairman, if there aren't any questions, I'd like to make the motion to recommend favorably to the full city council.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much. Item number two, three.
Order appropriation of $75,000 from appropriated estimated receipts ordinary revenue fiscal year 2017 to the DPW Water Commission Water Enterprise Fund desalination charges to provide additional funding for up to 15 days of purchase of desalinated water during the summer at the full contractual amount. The funds will allow the city to exercise a sustained full test of the system. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
This is before you, before us, I'll take whatever questions are sitting out there because it was referred back to committee.
Councilors, any questions? Entertain a motion?
Motion recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council.
On the motion, if I could.
On the motion, Councilor Sullivan.
Good evening, Mr. Condon. Mr. Condon, during the, I think the budget hearings, or when this came up, I think it was, I had asked if we could inquire with Aquaria to see if they would waive this and do it as gratis, much like they did when we denied the money last year, and they could have tried to go after us for penalties, and they waived it. And you had indicated that it hadn't been discussed yet, but that you would try to broach the subject.
Yeah, the problem with that is this, that there is, with respect to the penalties that they waived a year ago, that was money that they weren't expending, was just kind of a, okay. With respect to this, this is cost that they incur in producing the water, and I haven't raised it yet, but I have a hard time believing that they'd agree to it. So $75,000, substantial sum of money in terms of production cost.
Yeah, and I concur with that, but I do think there's no harm in asking.
Yeah.
Due to the fact that they really played cat and mouse with us for what, three and a half years, quite honestly. So, you know, that's my humble opinion. Why not ask? I'm sure they're going to say no.
Yep.
But it's worth it. If you know, if we catch them on a good day and they say we'll do half, right, then money saved.
No, I hear what you're saying. So if that's the will of the council to actually specifically make that request of them, we can do that.
Thank you. I'm going to put that in the, I'd like to attach that if I could to the motion.
In that case, actually,
who made the motion?
Withdraw your motion, Councilor Monahan.
Yeah, make a motion, withdraw my motion.
Second.
Councilor Monahan has withdrawn his motion. You would now have to make that.
Chairman, I'd like to make a motion to send this back favorably, but I'd like to, right, but I'd like to amend, well, the motion was withdrawn, so I'd like to put a condition precedent to the motion, asking the Chief Financial Officer of the City of Brockton, John Condon, to at least ask Aquaria if they would contemplate in good faith waiving the fee, any and all fees attributed to this $75,000 maximum.
Second.
Second.
Okay, so you have actually made a motion on an amendment. Do me a favor while we're voting on that. Can you just write that out quickly? If it needs to be written.
I think I can.
Motion is made and seconded to amend the order to include a request.
Can you read it after?
To have the fee waived. All those in favor of the amendment? All those opposed? Now, all those in favor of the order as amended, recommended favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full city council as amended.
So, councilors, I'll attempt to attain that answer before.
Thank you, Mr. Condon.
Item number four.
Order that pursuant to the provisions of the Master General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53A, the City Council hereby authorizes the acceptance and expenditure of the donation from CDM Smith made to the Department of Public Works. The list of donated items is going to be discarded by CDM Smith. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner.
Good evening, Mr. Riley.
Good evening. Councilors, this is CDM Smith is consolidating their office to another place, and they were willing to donate some furniture, and we looked at some pictures of it, and if it's accepted tonight, we'll accept it from them.
Motion recommend favorably.
Second.
On the motion, actually.
On the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Rowley, so where is the furniture going to go? What is it? What is it consist of?
We have a main office here at City Hall, and then I have two satellites at Montauk and Oak Hill Way.
Mm-hmm.
So some of it will go for the guys. Instead of sitting on milk crates, they'll have some chairs to sit on now.
Okay, the chairs, desks, other office supplies?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you. And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Mr. Rowley, are you going to be able to give us maybe a breakdown later on of what you actually got from them?
Yes, because like I said, we've only looked at pictures right now, so some of it we may take, some of it we may not.
And their value, ballpark figure and their value?
I could
basically
try.
The guesstimates?
I can try, Councilor. I don't know. I'd have to get that from them on what they spent, so.
All right, just a ballpark figure.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Mr.
I'll try. Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number five. Thank you, Mr. Rowley.
Order appropriation of $25,000 from the Executive Office of Housing and Economic Development Commonwealth Community Compact Grant Program to the City of Brockton Planning and Economic Development Commonwealth Community Compact Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Rob May, Director of Planning and Economic Development.
Good evening, Mr. May.
Good evening, sir. Councilors, asking you to appropriate funds from a grant that we accepted from the Commonwealth Community Compact from the Commonwealth, we need to appropriate it to a spending category.
Councilor Barnes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. May. Are there any matching provisions
no matches
to this at
required
all?
For this.
Okay. All right. Great. And anywhere in particular that it's going to go?
This grant is focused on the Campello neighborhood.
Okay.
And trying to create a visioning statement as the first piece of creating a master plan for the Campello neighborhood.
Okay. So does it consist of South Main Street all the way down that way, or is it really by the Hess or the Keith Park?
Starts around Nielsen and works its way south along Main Street to the to the border.
Okay. Okay. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. May. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you.
Motion recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number six.
Order that pursuant to the provisions of Mass General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53A, the City Council hereby authorizes the acceptance and expenditure of the donation of $8,668.98 from Brophy and Phillips to the City of Brockton Planning and Economic Development Department to replace the existing swing set and slide climbing equipment at the Ashfield School. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Rob May, Director of Planning and Economic Development.
Councilor Lally, anything on this, sir?
No, it's pretty straightforward. It's just accepting something that they'd originally promised with the agreement of a development.
Mr. May?
Yes, as a condition of a subdivision approval, the Brophy and Phillip Company, the developer who is developing the Parkview Lane, has made a donation to the city to assist the school department in replacing the playground equipment at the park at Ashford School.
It says it right there.
Yeah. Motion to recommend favorable.
Prior to the motion, Counselor Razak.
Good evening, Mr. May. What state is the actual equipment in right now that's at the Ashfield?
I do not know the nature of that equipment, what condition that equipment is in. This was a donation that was negotiated with former counselor of the ward. I believe it is in the process of being evaluated by the school department now for a total rehabilitation.
Okay. The reason I ask is, will it be donated? Will the existing one, the old one, be donated somewhere else in the city? You don't know.
That would be a question for the school department, ma'am.
Very good. Thank you.
Point of information from Councilor Lally?
Yes. The equipment there has been there for a long time, and it's been subject to a lot of vandalism, and I believe somebody actually lit it on fire once. Not entirely sure how they did it, but it's not in a condition for kids to play on it.
Thank you.
All set, Counselor?
Yes, thank you.
Counselor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. May, you may not know this if this was negotiated with former Counselor Dubois, but do you know how they came up with this exact amount? It seems very particular, the amount that's here for this.
They costed out the price of a similar swing set that's there now.
Okay, does it include installation?
It's a donation of this amount of money that the school department is working on rebuilding that playground now.
Okay, so
if the money is going to be transferred to the school department, who will then spend it as part of their contract to.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe they were going to be installing it.
We're the conduit, no.
Got it. Okay. Thank you, Mr. May. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Reaney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thought I saw Aldo Petronio here in the audience. Is he not?
Yes, he's
Aldo,
right.
Can you shed some light on this? I would think, since you're the money man over there, you must know a little.
The money man. I like that.
As far as the playground goes, our facilities department goes in and does what they can do.
Right.
On hand, if there's anything that has to be put in by a special contractor, whether it's, you know, a special service or something, well, you know, we'll go out to bid if necessary and bring someone in to do it. But otherwise, we try and handle most of that in-house.
Okay. Because I know in some of the other school locations, and I know I can speak on behalf of the Kennedy, and I even think Downey and a few others, I think at one point in time when theirs had to be replaced, donations were made to the parent advisory councils of the PTA, and then they accepted it, and then they did their installation. That's how it used to work. I would think that's probably how this may be working.
Yes,
and that's the way I'm. I don't want to wear my 20-year-old hat because I get yelled at when I do.
In some of those situations, we put up, let's say, $10,000, and the PAC would put up $10,000, and they'd try and raise additional. Some of these companies would donate, so we each put in a piece and get it all done.
Correct. Because most of them, as you go around all of the other school locations, usually, and even if you look at the one at the Huntington, was the same, which is down in my ward, the same situation. But most of you, I know at the Kennedy School, was an old set from years ago, and it just got demolished, and the new one replaced it about 3 or 4 years ago. That's how it went in play.
Exactly.
But if that helps shed any light to some of the other members, I would think that's how it would work. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Aldo.
Thank you. Now I'd entertain your motion, Counselor.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number 7.
Mr. Chairman?
Counselor.
I'd like to move that we take items 7, 8, and 9 collectively because I think after our legislative council addresses the body, that will be dispositive of these three items.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take items 7, 8, and 9 collectively. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, can you read 7, 8, and 9?
Order that pursuant to the Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53E1/2, the City Council authorizes the reestablishment of the Animal Control Revolving Fund for fiscal year 2017, the K-9 Unit Revolving Fund for the purpose of the cost and connection with the K-9 Unit of the Brockton Police Department, and also the reauthorization of the Police Department Closed Cases Revolving Fund for fiscal year 2017. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Mark Gilday, Legislative Counsel, Thomas Tichilla, Supervisor of Animal Control, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Attorney Gilday, I think you're probably the first one we want to hear from on this, possibly the only one we need to hear from tonight.
Good evening.
Councilor Farwell?
Yes, just Attorney Gilday, this was postponed until this evening because there was a question about the statute under which these are being reauthorized, and I understand you did some legal research, and if you would share that, I'd appreciate it.
Certainly. The cited statute authorizes the establishment of a revolving fund for certain purposes. Revolving funds are established by vote of the City Council upon recommendation of the mayor. The statute requires that such an authorization be made annually, each year before the start of a fiscal year. There are certain instances when revolving funds may be established during the course of a fiscal year, for example, when a new revenue source is identified during the fiscal year. However, I believe the three orders that are before you are actually reestablishment of revolving funds, so I don't think that exception would take effect here. So I believe that the revolving funds should have been reestablished prior to the start of the fiscal year. Happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Council, is this was a simple date error. We met in late June. We did not act on this before July 1st. We're not talking about a lot of money, particularly as a dog lover. If the animal control people need some funds, I'm certainly sure the mayor could put in an appropriation. And as for the other two requests, again, if it's not a lot of money, if the police department needs $35,000 for specific reasons, I'm sure that we could accommodate that through the normal appropriation process. So it would be my recommendation that we vote on this. I'd make a motion that we favorably recommend, but I will be voting no on the motion.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to recommend favorably.
On the motion, if I could.
On the motion.
Through you, Mr. Chair. Attorney Gilday. I think it was stated that past practice in the past, I guess these revolving accounts have been enacted or reapproved post fiscal year throughout the city of Brockton. So if that's the case, then in the past, it wasn't abiding by the standard.
I'm sure there may have been some instances when the revolving funds were established after the start of the fiscal year.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions before, and Councilor, just an explanation. The reason there's a motion to approve, even though he has stated he will vote against it, is you cannot make a negative motion. So the motion is to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Is recommended favorably to a full City Council. Item number 10.
Resolved that the Brockton City Council opposes lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Kathleen Smith, JD, Superintendent of Schools.
And just before Superintendent Smith steps up, I see School Committeeman Minicello and Sullivan out there. I'm not sure if I missed it. I see School Committeeman Sullivan and Minicello. I think that's it, but I want to thank you for being here on this hot summer night. Council Beauregard, you file this.
Yes, I did. It was a request because many of us are strong proponents of saving our public schools. And before the fiscal year ended in 2016, we had the school department come and discuss the challenges fiscally with this change for a charter school, a for-profit charter school here in Brockton. So I wanted to file this resolve to state where we stand in support of our public schools and our public school system.
Thank you. Mrs. Smith, I don't know if we need to say a lot more on this, but you certainly can let us know where we are, what's going on.
First of all, I want to thank Anne Beauregard, Councilor Beauregard. Our school committee members, dating back to an early May meeting, voted and the mayor did sign a resolve against lifting the cap on Commonwealth charter schools. I think we've passed a copy out to each of you at this time. You know, you can certainly read that and go through it for people in kind of our listening audience. I would like to talk about, again, it's been no secret that myself as superintendent, certainly our school committee and many members of our school community have opposed lifting any cap on charter schools. Many of you have watched the situation in Brockton. We do have a charter school, a Commonwealth charter school, which is very different, and I would be happy to come back and take a lot of your time, because it certainly took a lot of my time, of understanding the differences in charter schools. Horace Mann charter schools, there's 1, 2, and 3 different levels. And when you look at, and I want to go back to the intent of 1993 when ed reform came in, It was truly a compromise, and at the time it talked about no more than 25 charters would be given in our Commonwealth. And at the time, those charters were to come in, there was some autonomy from the contract, maybe it was a difficult population, where they would have autonomies, a longer school day, which was unheard of back in 1993, very much something we even have in our own district now. And the idea was to provide best practices and to share with the district public schools and to be able to have that kind of a partnership where you would work together. I don't have to give people a history. It certainly is a very different case now. Mm-hmm. When you look at the charter school that is coming in Brockton, a New Heights Charter School, which will be opening its doors to middle school students in September, one of the things that's very clear to me is there was not this kind of discussion. The discussion was very much supporting a school and services which we offer in the Brockton Public School District now. We're not the city of Boston, and I say that not disrespectfully. You know, there have been opportunities for charters in other districts, and what we have here is a school district system that works for every single youngster. You look at the number of students we're graduating. You look at the number of opportunities for students that need a different path. You look at choice, whether it's private schools, whether it's neighboring towns that have school choice. There are many choices for the students in our district. I'm not afraid of competition. Please make no mistake about that. But the one thing that is very clear to me, and you look at a governor who is very much and has always supported the charter school movement, I am very concerned for us as a Commonwealth. This right now is really going to be a pilot in Brockton, and I don't have to go into whether this is going to be successful or not. I will tell you that as superintendent of the Brockton Public Schools, it does matter to me about every single child and the education they receive, whether it's a public school, whether it's a private school, or whether it's a charter school. But at this point in time, and many of you have watched, and thank you for the support the mayor has given us, the city council has given us, with very, very difficult budgets, we will open in September. And I guarantee you we will continue to give critical education to every one of our youngsters, our top performers, our students that struggle. Everyone will come into the Brockton Public Schools, have opportunities, arts, athletics, an excellent education. And I see this, if you look deep into this raising of the charter cap, it truly are dollars leaving our district public schools, which educate at least 96% of the students in our Commonwealth. So I'm happy to answer questions. Again, you have the resolve before you, and we would certainly invite you to join us on signing on to this resolve.
You all set, Councilor Beauregard, for now?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, good evening, Superintendent. I have heard that the charter school that is in Brockton now is not full. Is that true? Or would somebody know on that? Because that's what I've been hearing.
When you say full, the charter was given for 305 students of 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. My understanding was out of that, at least 95% would be students from Brockton. I will tell you that I was led to believe back in February when the charter was approved that people were, and truly this was from the chairman of the Board of Education, Paul Sagan at the time. I sat there, it was difficult to listen to it, but he talked about people banging down the doors to be able to, in Brockton, come and embrace this choice. Well, we haven't seen that at all. You know, and we are very much doing within the law what we need to do. We've had numerous meetings with the charter school people. We've talked about transportation because, as I told you, children come first, whatever school they attend. You know, we've talked about recently a meeting we had about looking at some special education students. So when you ask if they're full, at this point here, I think that is in question. I would not say they're full. The numbers that I'm having, we probably do have about 197. We actually had to inform them that before we could provide information to the charter, we needed to have signatures from parents, something as simple as obviously, you know, when you have a transcript, it doesn't matter what school system you're leaving for, parents have to give permission for those students to be able to send that information to the other school district. So, you know, I do have my concerns. I will continue to watch this process, but we are prepared for our students that the parents have signed the permissions for transcripts to certainly have been sending those records over to the charter. So I want to say at this point about 190, but that's clearly not banging down the doors. And that number will be much more firmer to me when I not only open the doors, but I think every one of you knows that I'll be watching that October 1st number. And I'll continue to report back to the community after October 1st, because I do not want to see a wholesale children coming back to the Brockton Public Schools. I think each one of you knows that October 1st date, when you're talking about critical funding and a budget as tight as we have, that is how we are funded, and we very much rely on state funding for our students, for every student.
That's great. So obviously, I think most people think Brockton Schools is an advantage over a charter school from what we're hearing right now. And we don't need to lift any cap on it, that's for darn sure. But thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Burns.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Superintendent Smith, I just have just some clarification question, if you can. I got a few calls actually this week about a rally or something that the Yes on Two folks were having somewhere. I don't even know where they were having it, but I got a couple calls. And one of the representatives, he mentioned something about the cap. The lifting of the cap would not affect Brockton in some kind of way, or there's something about that we're not eligible. And I told him, you know, we've been sold that lie before. We were allegedly not eligible last time, but, you know, they were granted the waiver, and now here we are, you know, facing, you know, to have this charter school. So if you can maybe just explain that a little bit to me and maybe the folks at home that might hear that.
I believe when he answered that to you, so every district has a certain percentage of seats, they're called. So in Boston, and I'm going to use Boston as an example in comparison to our Brockton. So in Boston, they have reached a point where they do not have space for students. They supposedly have a waiting list, and they do not have additional seats based on the legislation that is presently in front of us. Brockton does have seats. Right now, we have 305 seats that have been granted on a 5-year charter to New Heights Charter School. They, of course, have talked about expansion. You know, that'll yet to be seen. And I most recently, and I have not read the newspaper, but I know that we were contacted today. Last week, I received a prospectus from a school out of Long Beach, California, a place I have to tell you I loved visiting, looking at their public school district at the start of my superintendency. Excellent, excellent things. Obviously, a very large district when you talk about California districts. So I'm hearing that this particular charter has been denied, I think, 4 times in Long Beach and is now looking to come to, and of course, it's Brockton, it's Avon, and it's Stoughton. I am going to be meeting with the superintendents in those locations very soon. And what I thought would be a year that I could focus on education in Brockton has very much become another political, as far as I'm concerned, battle, you know, to make sure that our parents, you know, and the way that I can do that is to provide an excellent education in the Brockton Public Schools under the circumstances, to make sure every student has an opportunity to succeed. But this doesn't stop, counselor, people that see that seat capacity. Okay. And I think it's about 1,400. I could be wrong on the exact percentage. When they look at your overall student body of, let's say, 18,000 students, I think it's 9%. They look at a certain percentage of what your seat capacity is. So we have seat capacity.
So now, just based off what you just said, so there's a charter system in Long Beach, California,
mm-hmm.
that is interested in coming into Brockton, another one?
Correct. They would be starting, obviously, a chapter in Massachusetts. The prospectus came to me from an organization in Long Beach, California. I have reviewed it very quickly. It'll be the same process that we went through with New Heights Charter. It goes through a process where the Board of Education vets it, has conversations. The commissioner decides whether he is going to recommend, similar to what we've been through, I think, is this our third year? The first year we fought it and won. Last year it was put in. Yeah, so this has been our third year running.
So now, is there some kind of mechanism where the department or you as the representative maybe can suggest that they go to like a place like Holyoke, where the state has taken over their system? And maybe they can go there.
You know what's interesting? When you looked at, and there was recently a bill that went before the Senate, and I did talk to Senator Brady about this, and I never thought I'd see the day where there was actually an excellent compromise, and I think it was trying to, you know, offset this being a ballot question. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, people love choice. You know, you go to the ballot and it says to you, why wouldn't we want more choices for our parents? Check yes, choice is good. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And I have to tell you, I love the commercial that's out there, which is now talking about no on question two. And it talks, again, about that 96, 98% of kids, the kids that are here in Brockton, the kids that are in Holyoke, that are getting an excellent education. There's certainly oversight. When you look at Holyoke right now, the DESE has oversight there.
Right. They took them over.
You know, right. So you're saying that might be a place where a charter has traction. Yeah. But, you know, I cannot stand here and tell you one of the things about the Senate compromise. And it made it out of the Senate. I don't believe it passed in the House of Representatives. And that was the Mass Association for School Superintendents, the Mass Association for School Committees, a number of groups coming together and talking about ways, again, I go back to that 1993 where you come together, you know, with a charter and you talk about autonomies and ways to really help a public school district maybe deal with students that need a longer school day, students that need additional supports. You know, we could continue to go on and on about it. But it also talked about, you know, if you look at a number of stances on this particular thing, you really start to divide school districts. We have to take every student that comes to our door, and I welcome, and I've told you this, I don't care if they're homeless, I don't care if there's trauma, we do an excellent job with every student that comes through our doors. When you look at charter, and it typically, they can tell you all they want. You know, we're accepting English language learners, we're accepting special needs students, up to a point. And when the going gets rough, the child ends up back in the public school district. And again, we're happy to have those children. I don't want to see complete disruption where I have kids in and out of a door because parents have been sold, you know, this is choice, this is wonderful. And I'm going to take a step back because this charter is coming in September. I'm not sure how they're going to perform. I hope they're going to certainly service these students in an ethical way and a productive way for every one of the students. So I will be reporting to you on a regular basis, but I can't answer those questions. But Counselor, the other thing when you mentioned, you know, going someplace else, I did like that there was an opportunity in this compromise bill that talked about the community had to want this particular charter to come into their community, mm-hmm. to be invited in, mm-hmm. to have the support of the community. And you did not have that here in Brockton, not at any point that I have been superintendent. I've watched the parents speak, I've watched the public speak, I've watched the teachers speak, and at no time did I ever get the feeling from our elected officials that this was something that we were welcoming to help us out in Brockton.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Counselor Farwell.
Superintendent Smith, I'd like to go back to February. I think you mentioned that if we were allowed to send in the initial October 1st enrollment, but then by February 1st, send in the actual enrollment numbers, because in a gateway city like Brockton, it can change dramatically. I mean, 300 or 400 students could literally come in for any number of reasons. Am I accurate that I hear you say that? And would it, is that something that you think we might want to offer to the other gateway cities and we all get together and say, look, we're in a unique position. Give us until February 1st.
So, Councilor, not only am I saying that to you, so right now the October 1st date is firm. So with Chapter 70 funding, and obviously we know how much we rely on our state support, that date is the date that we get per pupil for the students that are in the Brockton Public Schools on October 1st. And we work frantically to make sure we have everybody in our student management system so we're able to report that accurately. We did, and I thank, and you always hear me thank, our Chief Budget Officer, Aldo Petronio, because back 2 years ago, the state looked at their Chapter 70 funding formula and invited districts to come and share some of the concerns. Mr. Petronio was at every one of those meetings, and I'm talking statewide. I told you he was in Western Mass on a Friday night and stayed there so he could be there for that Saturday conference. And they knew him, and they trusted him. And he talked about English language learner and the support and the funding that we wanted to see changed in Chapter 70. We talked about special education students. One of the biggest things we talked about was that October 1st date. And I believe Aldo looked even beyond February 1st. I think he was really pushing it. but we would have certainly gone for a February 1st date, because again, during that school year, you're right, we could have a swing of 200 or 300 students that normally have been students that are coming to Brockton, not leaving Brockton in that time. So we have already begun to do that, and don't forget, the governor had those recommendations before him and chose in this budget session not to review those recommendations from Chapter 70.
Well, if the mayor and Mr. Minicello and you advance something that might become a home rule petition that we could have other communities sign on to, I think there are some procedural things that we could do to help ourselves, because I have to tell you, putting aside whether people have pro or con viewpoints on certain things, it just seems like the state is always giving us a knockout punch on any time we try to advance the fiscal stability of the community. And you know, I'm not a paranoid person, but if you read about what happens to Brockton on every single decision, you almost wonder, is there some curse that's that the state has imposed upon us? And you may not want to comment, but I'm sure you know where I'm coming from.
I'll tell you a great opportunity. I haven't had a chance to formally get out an invitation because we're just firming this up. And I want to thank former Councillor Jay Stewart on this. And what I'm going to talk about is Jace works for the Department of Elementary Secondary Education. I am always pleased, and I've worked with Jace for years, well before he became an elected official, and always puts Brockton in the right light about what you're doing, what we're doing for students, what's happening in Brockton. And I bring this up because the commissioner, in looking at a reconfiguration of his staff, and also I think some consulting work that went on, one of the things that came back to the commissioner was, we are the top state for performance in the nation. Yeah. And those are, again, public school students when you talk about top performance. And it doesn't matter if it's an urban district, doesn't matter if it's a suburban district, when you look at us as a whole. And one of the things that came back to him was, in communicating to superintendents, he got excellent ratings. We have conversations with the commissioner. I feel like I can pick up the phone at any time and have called him, and sometimes things that are not necessarily pleasant. We've always had excellent conversation. So one of the things the commissioner has asked, and I bring up Jace, Jace brought up Brockton. The commissioner is looking to start an opportunity where he has dialogue with the public. He is coming here on September 20th. Okay. It's going to be his first time actually coming to a community in the evening. I thought it was going to be more controlled. I was actually talking to his staff. He wants to see, we had about 500 parents and family members when we did the kickoff for Brockton Kids Count, which again, we're going to continue to really start to support our parents in many, many ways, not just about a budget, but having a voice, getting them involved in the schools. And he wants to come on the 20th. We're hoping from 6 to 7. I want to firm up the location and we'll get back to each and every one of you. He will come and he wants to take questions. And I'm not talking about people getting up and grandstanding. We'll probably collect questions. We've got a certain amount of time. He's willing to address many questions. And he is then coming before the school committee. It is a regular scheduled meeting. And we do have a number of things we're going to address with him. We are going to talk about the accountability system, the new ESSA that has come out in place of No Child Left Behind. We're going to talk about technology. And when you talk about some districts that have one-to-one devices, with the high-stakes testing, they just changed it from 2019 to 2020, but it's still coming fast and furiously for these kids to get their high school diploma based on an online test. So it is going to be our opportunity, I think, as a community, you know, to certainly address some things with the commissioner.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Superintendent. How are you this evening?
How are you?
I'm good, thank you. Just a couple of quick points, and believe it or not, I'll even be brief about it, but I know the only time in my history where I ever voted for a charter school, that was when we were under the Horace Mann some many years ago, and it was a school here called the Champion Charter School, and was very, very successful because of the way it was operated and how it went through the Horace Mann process and believed in it, and it really helped a lot of our youngsters at that particular point in time in those years be very much successful when they were in that setting. So, I mean, as far as I'm concerned, there'd be no way I would ever support lifting a cap on charter school. And it makes me wonder just in the past week how successful this charter school is going to be, since we've already moved from one location to another location, which is right next door to where I work on Main Street. So we went from Main Street North to Main Street South, and didn't even realize it happened until, I didn't even realize it happened until just about 4 days ago when somebody approached me and said, welcome, the charter school's next door to you with the Overizon building. And, you know, a flag did go up. Nothing I can do about, nothing any of us can do about it, you know what I mean? But my boss's wings went up a little bit to, you know, I didn't know something like that was coming to be within our neighborhood. Well, that's what the state does to Brockton.
And not only that, Counselor, when you talk about that situation, unfortunately, we have very limited funds when you talk about net, non-net school spending.
Right.
You know, the mayor and I are working very closely together, looking for every dollar to make sure our children can be transported. So the point I'm going to make is when you have plans and you have a downtown location,
right,
a central location, it is a 2-mile walkout for middle school students. And we are going to be able to do this. And I thank Deputy Superintendent Thomas. And we sat down last Thursday. But again, another hurdle when you talk about a different location, you know, farther down. And, you know, I'm pleased. I think we're going to be able to do it within a tier of our busing rather than, you know, costing us additional money.
Right.
And I do want to say, Counselor, when you mentioned the Champion City back then, the thing that we all have to realize about charter schools and back then a Horace Mann charter school, mm-hmm, you still had a school committee and a superintendent that had some oversight. So you're talking about taxpayer dollars. You know, the budget can be very different. There are some autonomies from the contract, but you still had somebody that you were accountable to for those tax dollars.
Exactly. The only point I would probably say in looking at the facility that they're going to go into, because of being familiar with the piece of property, there's probably area for them to have some recreational, which I thought and had no say about, but in the first setting, where was your recreational area going to be for those students? It couldn't be on the rooftop. You know what I mean? I thought that was, in my own opinion, I didn't think that was a setting for any type of a school. But down there, I can understand the situation. But still, here you are already scrambling, and I'm watching them scramble all day today. And, I mean, it's just in a demo mode that's just unbelievable in hopes that they can get to do what they want to do in time. So it makes you wonder how successful and how, you know, how the process is going to be for them. So that's just my
own
point.
And you and I both agree that really it comes down to making sure these kids, again, that's my concern.
Right.
It's always about the opportunity,
yeah,
for these
and
children.
It is going to be a busy area too. It's much more busy than what you have here. So, you know, best of luck to them. But in any case, you have my support on this.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Superintendent.
Good evening.
I had actually, Councilor Farwell and yourself already touched on what I'm going to speak about, but I attended those hearings. I heard parents, students, faculty, everybody from Brockton speak against the charter school. Very few that I heard that really wanted this charter school to come in here. There was multiple hearings. You went to numerous, not just the community here, but you went to meetings outside of the city, yet the state still decided to have this charter school come into the city. So what I'm asking is, what can we do? I mean, I feel like we're not being heard. Obviously, we didn't want it. I've heard from maybe two people that were actually, that spoke that they liked the idea, but when I explained to them what I had learned about this type of charter school, they definitely changed their minds. What can we do to make sure that we are being heard? That, yes, I can say I'm not for lifting the cap on charter schools, but can we educate the parents? What can we get the PACs more involved? Really, because we can't have something like this happen to us again. It takes away from our public schools, and we understand that.
Yeah. I think you know certainly the power of the voice. I mean, you're in elected office. I'm sure you're listening to voices all the time. And when we talked about the Brockton Kids Count campaign, I really wanted to, you know, parents, our parents, to really start to focus on what we want for education for our children in the future. What kind of things do we want to make sure that we're keeping in our public school system? And some of that isn't simply just, you know, excellent opportunities, class sizes that are reasonable, making sure our kids have after-school opportunities, making sure that they're involved in athletics, in the arts, in music, all of the things that really make us the city that we are. And we're very different than many other cities in being able to continue forward under very stressful times. So I think it's when you ask, what can we do? You know, certainly we've come together as a community. I've never seen so many parents come together. That was a connected phone call. That was certainly a dialogue. I know we've gone on to other things where we're still trying to get through the summer to open up schools. I loved seeing on very few dollars, you know, Brockton Kids Count everywhere I went. We had a couple of wonderful donors. And when you heard me say, starting the school year, I want those parents' voices. It isn't just about necessarily a budget. It's about educating parents, our bilingual parents, our special education parents. They have their own PACs. Making sure that it's not okay, and we're starting out when we have open houses to talk about our plan for Brockton Kids Count, to make sure parents have a voice, register to vote, get involved in their child's education program. Can we really start to take a look at opportunities where we have volunteers come into the schools and work with our children in ways that keep the parents involved? So I think a lot of that comes from going those extra miles. I think we've started to do that, and it's not that we haven't always been looking. And those of you that have had kids in the elementary school, you know what it's always been like trying to get parents to come to a PAC meeting. People are very busy, and they always think that it's going to be somebody else that's going to, you know, carry the ball, so to say. So I think it's incumbent upon us, and that's all of us, not just the schools, to make sure that we are making sure our parents have a voice and get involved, and more than just have a voice, are educated about what the issues are.
That's what I agree with, and I'm thinking, you know, it's I know the question will be on the ballot, but kind of educating the sending something out saying, this is if public schools are important to you, and this vote no on lifting the cap, kind of how
I think we've got to be very careful, you know, with the advocacy. I'm very much speaking to you about it. I agree. We'll take opportunities as a school committee. I appreciate you giving us this opportunity tonight to speak to the public, to speak to each of you. So we will be working on ways that, you know, I know the school committee has told me that the vote no on question two group has asked to come before the school committee. I believe they're going to come to a hearing of visitors if the school committee has additional questions. Of course, there's always equal access. Yeah. You know, it is a public meeting. But we will do our best to educate our parents.
Well, thank you again. And once again, you have my support. I always rave about our public schools. And I have two young girls that are really a product of Brockton Public Schools. I'm very proud of them and proud of the school system. So thank you.
Not so young anymore. High school.
I know.
One high school.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Madam Superintendent.
Council.
I just first of all want to thank you and the mayor and the members of the school committee. This is a very, very well-written resolve. And I think what really hits home is the last whereas, where you're saying, whereas lifting the cap on charter schools would greatly worsen the problems listed above, and this is the key right here, and lead to a costly and divisive two-track school system. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what happens, and that's what will happen. And, you know, we're not naive to the fact that the current governor and the Board of Education is no friend to Brockton. And now you're making us aware that there's another proposed location coming from the West Coast. It's just not fair to the students, to the teachers, to the personnel that are working so hard to, and have worked hard to really make Brockton Public Schools the top of the echelon. So you know you have my support and all my colleagues here in the City Council, so whatever we can do. But thank you for giving us this. I hadn't seen this, but again, I want to just applaud everybody. This is really well written. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I'd like to motion to recommend this favorably.
Second. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full City Council.
Thank you.
Thank you, Superintendent Smith.
Thank you.
Item number 11.
Resolved that the City CFO and Treasurer appear before the Finance Committee to discuss the practice and procedure of credit card authorization and usage by certain city employees. Invited John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Martin Brophy, Treasurer, Tax Collector, and Heidi Chuckren, Auditor.
Chairman.
Prior to Councilor, I did receive a communication from Mr. Brophy, who could not be here tonight. He had a previous engagement. Okay. Councilor Sullivan.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilors, I filed this resolve, and I think it's long overdue. I many years ago, when I first got elected to the City Council, I sat on the Accounts Committee, and I know a lot of you, five of you, sit on that Accounts Committee to this day. I think really the purpose and the intent of this resolve is to educate the councilors and also to inform us relative to oversight. So I don't know, you know, who generated this spreadsheet, but I think it's definitely going to to assist on this tonight. So with that being said.
You can credit MRA for that. Put the spreadsheet together.
I had a few questions when I reviewed it, and thank you for giving it to us tonight. It looks to me that what's listed is 8 city departments, which would be public property, DPW, water, sewer, DPW, highway, library, fire, parks, Board of Health, and Council on Aging, and then also the schools. And on the city side, the city departments, those 8, it looks like there's 12 cards, and they run the gamut from Home Depot to Lowe's to Sears to Staples. And then on the school side, again, it's Lowe's, AC Moore, Home Depot, Costco, Bank of America, Shaw's, Albertson. This is helpful, but I had some questions. So is this the only departments that have any credit cards in the city of Brockton?
Yes.
So go ahead, if you
these
could.
These credit cards have been in place for well before me and the treasurer, 15, 20 years.
Okay.
Ever since I've been in office and the treasurer, there's been no new credit cards.
Okay. In terms of, I volunteer time on some certain boards, and I know other boards really recently have kind of run the gamut on examining this, from petty cash within certain departments, municipal departments, and also private corporation departments. So in terms of this credit card, I mean, police department's not here, mayor's not here, treasurer collector's not here. So those departments don't have credit cards?
No credit cards. Treasurer's department has a petty cash fund.
Okay.
So they would use the petty cash fund.
And that's limited to a certain dollar amount?
$1,000, I believe.
$1,000. Okay. So when Mayor Carpenter or Mayor Belzardi or Mayor Harrington, when they travel, and we give budgeted amount for travel, so when Mayor Carpenter goes to D.C.
he puts it on his personal card and gets reimbursed.
He gets reimbursed from his personal account.
Yeah.
Okay. So in terms of what I think I'm surprised at here is that I see Bank of America, but I don't see any other credit cards with local banking institutions. Harbor One, Rockland Trust, whatever, the local ones, Crescent Credit. And I know Jay Stewart's name was mentioned tonight. And I know when Councilor Stewart served on here, one of his, to his credit, one of his things was we should be using more local banking institutions. So I guess that intrigues me relative to that. I also, I guess maybe we could examine the practices. So there's a limit amount per credit card?
I'm not sure what the limit amounts on the credit cards are.
Okay.
But I know they're not large expenditures on these.
Okay.
Typically.
It's typically someone has to run up to Lowe's to buy hardware. They'll just use a credit card. But in terms of usage, so then who reviews that? Does the department head review that before it goes to the auditor?
Yes.
Okay.
Every department head reviews their own bills, signs off on them.
Okay.
They are re-reviewed, though, when they come through my office. So if there's any questions at that time, they bring them to myself or Anne-Marie.
Yeah, and again, I'm not finger-pointing, and you guys were really helpful when I was on accounts committee, and I hope to be on there again someday. But I think what's educational to a lot of the new counselors and a lot of us that have been here for a long time, I mean, I didn't know what it was. That's why I filed this resolve. Like who has a credit card? What's the usage? What's the oversight? What's the practice? Who vets it out? So I think at the end of the day, if this is really the only credit cards, and we're not talking about a nominal amount, the library is, there's no authorized person there, I suspect, because there's only an acting library director right now?
Correct.
Okay. And then much like a personal, if I charge something on my Amex, I'm going to pay it off next month. So is this paid off monthly or quarterly?
Yes, no, monthly.
It's monthly? And is there a reason, maybe this is more for you, Mr. Conlon, is there a reason why, maybe it's an interest rate or maybe it's just a business practice, why local banking institutions aren't using? I'm only looking at the Bank of America one.
I think it's because the credit card has been outstanding for many, many, many years, and as Bank of America acquired banking institutions, some of them may have been local
Fleet,
at one time. I think
yeah,
Fleet
yeah,
might have been
yeah.
acquired by them. The credit card was reissued by the acquiring bank, and it's just continued because it was already outstanding card.
Okay. Okay, and the interest rate's probably favorable.
I'm sorry? Yes.
The interest rate's probably favorable.
I think favorable. So, but I don't think that's being examined because we're not anticipating.
It's paid off monthly anyhow.
The interest to pay it off, yeah.
Okay. Mr. Chair, I'm going to send this back to you with the caveat, though, councilors. I will, at the end of this, if other people have questions, I welcome that. But I eventually will make a favorable recommendation back to the full council with the caveat that I'm then going to, at that time, send it to a council committee. I think the five members of the council committee should delve into this. Not saying that you haven't, you probably do. But I wasn't aware that there was this many credit cards, and I've been here 11 years. So with that being said, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Burns.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Like Councilor Sullivan, I've sat on a lot of different boards and things, and we've had check writing abilities and all these kinds of things, treasury roles and all of that. So in that capacity, we had to be bonded. And I'm not sure if the credit card situation is the same when you have municipal employees and personnel kind of spending city money or spending money. So, and I'm looking here, and it specifically states, like, the people, like, these are actually attached to the actual people that have the authority to use these cards. But I'm wondering, is it with those actual people? So if they're removed from their position or they move or anything, is it with the position or the person? And are they... Is there a need to be bonded to use these credit cards?
The second question is no. The treasurer is bonded. Remember, the fact that a charge has been incurred on these credit cards does not mean that the city has to pay it. It doesn't have to pay it. If the auditor deems that charge to have been illegal or excessive, the bill can be denied and they'd have to chase us in court. So before that bill gets paid, it's signed off by the department head. This is true for any purchase in the city, councilor. Okay. It's signed off by the department head. It's signed off by the auditor. It's signed off by the mayor, and it's signed off by the treasurer. And the treasurer, in fact, is bonded.
Okay, so I guess I'll hold that other question, though. So has that happened before? Has there ever been a determination where a charge has been inappropriate?
I don't think so, but I'm telling you that the auditor has the ability to stop payment on any incurred obligation of the city under Mass General laws.
Okay. And I guess the next question, so it's with the person itself or with the position? So
no, these cards are with the positions, okay, within the department.
So it would say, for instance, on this, like the Home Depot one, so it would say, like, Brockton Fire Department?
He's the supervisor of building. Correct. It doesn't have the individual's name on it, I don't believe.
Okay. And I mean, maybe this too can go through the accounts or you know, through your office. So these eight or so departments, is there some kind of written procedure on how to keep these credit cards safe or locked up or track or anything like that, or are they just kind of like in a drawer?
I'd have to check on that.
Okay.
Honestly.
Maybe that can go through accounts as well. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Ianieri, because these are questions for accounts, so Councilor Ianieri, then we'll...
If I might just want to make one point, because as City Councilor Sullivan mentioned, to send it back to the Accounts Committee. I know the Accounts Committee's already asked a couple of questions as we've been meeting quite frequently, as the Accounts Committee didn't do for a few years, but we have been, and we'll be meeting in September again. So we will take this and discuss it further. I think what now opens up my eyes a little bit is when I hear the word petty cash, and I get a little leery when I hear about petty cash accounts and how many of those exist. So just to let colleagues know, I mean, as we're discussing this item, we're going to probably be discussing that as well. So if you want to...
I can make a comment on that.
Sure.
Years ago, there were a number of departments, if you would have looked in budget books from 15, 20 years ago, which had petty cash accounts. Truthfully, I'm much more nervous about cash sitting around in petty cash accounts that can be accessed and actually taken to... There's less control over it. Well, and I don't remember having new credit cards authorized, but I think it's a safer situation than the petty cash accounts. There are only a couple left of those petty cash accounts.
I'm not disagreeing with you on that, Mr. Conner. I would want us to see us go maybe the direction of more of a card. I think you can track a little bit more of a card than you can with petty cash. That's my own personal opinion, you know what I'm saying? Because everyone's hands in the, I don't care who or what, you know what I'm saying? It gets mixed up. But that we'll discuss at the Accounts Committee. But I just wanted my colleagues to know that will come up for discussion. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Just one second.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, Mr. Chuckard. Aren't these in the warrants as far as the payments to these separate credit cards?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I thought they were, yeah. I just was wondering, because I thought we had seen them before. But all right, that's what I thought. Thank you. Thank you,
Chairman. Make a favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to full city council, and we will Monday night send that to committee. Okay. Item number 12.
Resolve the mayor or his designee, the police chief and fire chief or their designees, the chairman of the license commission or his designee, the executive director of the Board of Health, and the superintendent of buildings be invited to appear before a committee of the city council to discuss ongoing code enforcement activities, available staffing, as well as specific objectives for the next fiscal year. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John Crowley, police chief and or his designee, Michael Williams, fire chief, or his designee, Louis Tataglia, the Board of Health Executive Director, James Cassiri, Superintendent of Buildings, Henry Tataglia, Chairman of License Commission, and or his designee.
Good evening, Councilor Fowell. You filed this, I believe.
Yes, I did. Good evening, Mr.
Good evening, Councilor.
As you know, I'm pretty passionate about code enforcement.
As am I.
I think that it enhances the quality of life in neighborhoods. I think it enhances the quality of life in business districts. And we're going to be making a concerted effort to do urban renewal downtown and all of the feeder areas coming in. Montello Street, North Montello Street, North Main, Main Street. People will be traveling through those areas in order to get to the downtown. Now, I see tonight as an information sharing session. I don't think code enforcement can be done in one night. So that said, what I'd like to do, and I'll certainly share these with you, but I'd like to share them with my fellow counselors so you'll get an idea of where I'm coming from. This happens to be a picture of a place at 515 North Main Street. It actually backs up onto Montello Street. It has way over the limit the number of vehicles that are permitted by the license. And the other thing is that we have an ordinance that says if you have more than five vehicles parked outside, you have to be on asphalt or cement. And this is on a grassy area, so probably we have some ground contamination. This is Elmond Auto Repair, 1000 Montello Street, excess number of vehicles allowed. And they also store vehicles on Pinkham Street, a piece mm-hmm. of property on Pinkham Street in Campello, which is not part of the license. So that is another issue that, again, we've got a whole fiscal year to take a look at this. It isn't as if it has to be done overnight, but we can certainly start attacking these. A&B Auto Repair, 649 Warren Ave, excess number of vehicles allowed, and this is a picture of the wrecker parked on the sidewalk for a protracted period of time. Obviously, people in wheelchairs or anyone else could not get down there. 1000 Montello Street, you know, you're out and about all the time. Take a ride down there. To me, it looks like a junkyard. I think they need a Class 3 junk license. I from what I have been able to determine, they don't have it. But, I mean, it's really an unsightly area. And as we're all working to improve the image of the city, I think it's important to do this. Brockton Auto Express, 155 North Montello Street, excess number of vehicles, parts are being stored outside. And this is another business which has taken over another piece of property to store vehicles which is not part of the license. Five Star Auto Body, 347 North Montello Street, vehicles parked outside over the limit allowed by the license, and they also have auto parts outside which is not allowed. Now, there are two places which I would tell my counselors are exceptional images of what we should have in Brockton. One of them is Soar's Auto Repair on Montello Street, and that's just south of Montello and Elliott. And if you take a ride by there, whoever owns that business, and I don't know any of these, I do know the owner of the next person, just peripherally, but whoever owns that business takes great pride in this city and make sure that his or her business is operating properly, and they should be commended. The next one is Modern Auto Body. This picture says it all. Perfect example of businesses closed during the day they work in the vehicles. When it's closed, pristine condition, absolutely the way it should be. We have another place, Dr. V's Auto Repair, 787 Main Street. Number of vehicles stored outside in excess of those allowed by the license. And once again, this business has apparently taken over another piece of property to store additional vehicles which are not part of the license.
Councilor, how many do you have? Because I think maybe it's difficult for the people at home and maybe
well,
we should...
Well, yeah, I'm the people at home, with all due respect, I think the councilors need to get a flavor for this, and I don't think it's, again, we're going to be able to get to the people at home.
I think we have enough to discuss and see where we are and all get right. our questions answered.
Well, Finish Line Auto, and then the last one, here's the last one which bothers me. V&A Auto Repair at 586 North Main Street. Now, that particular business was subject to a federal and state police and local police raid. Hand-to-hand buys and sales of drugs were going on there. We issued that license, and I have never seen a report come in saying, City Council, I think you might want to take a look at this business and hold a hearing mm-hmm. and determine if the license should be suspended, revoked, or what went on, gather the police reports. I mean, I think we as the issuing authority on the City Council should be proactive, as the License Commission is, when there are violations of the liquor laws, sales to minors, illegality on the premises. I mean, I think we as a council, and I've now been here 7.5 months, we've never had one hearing on a garage license violation. Now, either we have a city which is absolutely the way it should be, or these pictures, in fact, show that I think we need to work with the mayor and the police chief and the building superintendent and others to make sure that that's not a continuing problem. That's the V&A auto repair. So that's it in a nutshell. I don't know what the other councilors feel, but I really would like to work with whomever you designate to have a concerted effort to go after these types of violations, not just the abandoned vehicles, because I think it's Sergeant Schliemann, if I've pronounced
Schliemann.
Schliemann, he's done an excellent job on abandoned vehicles, but I do think there's a lot more we can do, and in the end, we're going to have a city that when people travel around, they're going to be proud of what they see. So having said that,
sure.
In an abbreviated form.
Councilor, if I could just make some general comments, and then all of the various department heads are here tonight, and we'll certainly give the Chief and Lieutenant LeGrice an opportunity to respond specifically around the issue of garage licenses. Code enforcement is a priority of this administration. I agree with everything you said in your opening remarks. As you know, I worked as an outside code enforcement officer for the Board of Health for 2 years before becoming mayor. I think that we've enhanced our commitment since our administration arrived to code enforcement and multi-agency cooperation. I think I couldn't agree with you more that effective code enforcement enhances the quality of life for residents and helps improve businesses in our business districts. We certainly respond to complaints every day, and we've in fact made it much easier for residents to file complaints than it used to be with the adoption of our C-Click Fix technology that allows people to download a free app on their Android or smartphone and report issues and complaints 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I think a feature that you and I would both agree on, Council, with C-Click Fix, and maybe you should try it out, is that adds a level of accountability. So in other words, when a report comes in on C-Click Fix, it's date stamped immediately when it comes in, it's acknowledged. When that department opens that complaint and acknowledges receipt of the complaint, there's another email that lets the person know that the department has received it. And then when they close out the file after investigating the complaint, they go on again and close it out, and there are email notifications at all those steps of the way. I think it's brought a level of accountability to this that we've never had before, and I'll tell you, I use it all the time. I drive around the city and see things I don't like also, just like you. And I'll be on a Sunday morning, you know, taking a picture of something and putting it in on C-Click Fix because I want to make sure that that report is waiting for someone first thing Monday morning. We have enacted a number of proactive campaigns, and I can't emphasize enough the multi-agency, multi-department cooperation council we've really fostered. We've got building, fire, police, Board of Health, all working cooperatively on a daily basis. It's on a daily basis, we have one department notifying other departments or visiting properties together. A recent example of that would be the convenience store across the street that we shut down a couple weeks ago for selling synthetic drugs. That was a joint code enforcement operation between the police department and the Board of Health inspectors, who together were able to effectively enforce that Board of Health regulation, and subsequently we've been able to negotiate a 90-day closure on that business for a first offense. So I think we've sent a clear message that we'll use code enforcement to prevent synthetic drugs from being sold in this city. But I will also say, and we'll certainly pass those along to the police department for immediate review. But I would also say that I think that we've tried to take an approach with code enforcement of working with people and working with business owners, and not just coming in on day one and saying, you better do this, you better do that, or else we're gonna shut you down, or we're gonna fine you $500. I think our approach has really tried to work cooperatively with residents and business owners. Quite often, they're in violation, but they may not realize why they're in violation, and that first contact should be explaining what the issue is and what you need to do to get into compliance.
treating people with respect, giving them the opportunity to comply, and then if the compliance doesn't come, then bringing down the hammer of the penalties that are available to us through the various city ordinance and codes. So I think you've seen us. We've got an ongoing targeted campaign at vacant properties, and we're getting several of those every week cleaned up and secured using the Vacant Abandoned Property Ordinance Fund. And that's working very effectively, and that has an immediate impact. Every house on that block is thrilled when we're able to tackle another one of those vacant properties that's not being maintained properly. And people can report those vacant properties on C-Click Fix. We've got a proactive campaign with graffiti, and we're removing graffiti every week, and we've made a huge dent in the amount of graffiti in the city. And I'm not saying it's ever completely eradicated, because it's not. But we've sent a clear message that if you put it up, we take it down. You put it up, we take it down again. And as many times as you put it up, we'll take it down, because that's the only effective strategy to combat graffiti in a city. And we're even more recently, and I think this has been an ongoing issue, but we gave it some additional attention recently in light of some desire expressed by the city council, and that's the clothing bins, collection, donation bins. And if you look around now, and Mr. Tartaglia can speak to this much more specifically, but I think you'll see a dramatic reduction in the number of those clothing bins around the city, because we've been able to use proactive code enforcement using the city's nuisance ordinance with the property owner as a motivational tool for the property owner to make the decision to just get rid of the box. It's not worth dealing with the city's code enforcement people every time it's a mess and overflowing. So I think we've got a lot of success and a lot of positive impacts to speak about. I will share your concern with any of the garages that you've highlighted, and we'll address them immediately. I think those are an ongoing challenge, but I do know that our police officers assigned to the License Commission are out there, because I hear the complaints. I hear the other side. I hear the complaints from the business owners that say your guys are harassing me. So I know I wouldn't be getting those complaints if there weren't people out there talking to these business owners. And I think in terms, and this is a conversation, Council, you and I have had before, but I would, you know, respectfully suggest that perhaps the council should take the same approach with the garage licenses as we did earlier this year with the late night permits that were formally administered by the mayor's office, and simply send them to the License Commission, put them under the purview of the License Commission, that's probably much better equipped to deal with violations, just as if with the mayor's office. I just simply suggest that perhaps it could be a topic of conversation and deliberation among the councilors.
I happen to agree with you. However we can enhance education and enforcement, we should. And let me be very clear, and I want my fellow councilors to know this. Education first, enforcement second. I am not suggesting that, like Gestapo, we send people out and say, we're going to tow that vehicle and we're going to shut you down. A lot of people are not used to business regulations. I would dare say probably 90% of the people in the city don't even know half of our ordinances exist. But slowly through education, going to a business person and saying, look, this is what your license says. This is what you have to do. I'm going to come back in a whatever period of time is chosen, and I'm going to make sure that's done. I think that would go a long way towards fostering cooperation and doing what
and
we
I
have
think,
to do.
Council, and I agree with that. I think that part of that conversation should also surround how do we make it much easier for the enforcement people out on the front lines to easily access the information that they need to do enforcement effectively, because I don't think it's always easily accessible to them, and that's something perhaps we could work together on also.
Well, I think my last comment would be if you and Chief Crowley would get together, I do think a business that's raided after having that much attention and that ongoing illegal activity that holds a license issued by us, I think the two of you should take a look at that and see if that should be sent to us to hold a hearing, because
I think what we need to do, and I'll gratefully accept your suggestion this evening, is extend something that we're already doing with residential properties. We've got the police department, whenever they conduct raids at multifamily properties, they are sending those addresses of those properties to the Board of Health,
where Mr. Tartaglia then has his enforcement people check to see if they're up to date on their certificates of fitness, and we send someone out to do a drive-by of the property to see if there's any violations we can see, because we are trying to send a clear message that if you're going to be an irresponsible property owner in this city, that you're going to get our nonstop attention until you become a responsible property owner. And I think we're doing that already in terms of rental properties, and I think what you're suggesting is simply perhaps that we extend that to commercial property also.
Mr. Chairman,
I'm going to step aside and give the all the various department heads an opportunity to answer questions.
No, I was going to make a final comment. When all councilors have had a chance to ask any questions, I am going to ask that this be postponed for 3 months and then get a report back on the issues that have been raised tonight and any other statistics that you'd like to bring in on how we're doing, because we have literally 10 months left in the fiscal year, and I think we can make a big impact.
And Councillor, my final comment would be a continuation of a conversation you and I had a couple months ago regarding the city adopting Chapter 40U.
Yes.
I think that's a very proactive step that this council could take that would put some more teeth into our code enforcement. That, councilors, would allow us to have the city conduct its own due process hearings on civil fines, civil tickets that are issued. Right now, they're done at the Southeastern Housing Court. The Southeastern Housing Court is a court of compliance. If by the time that person gets their hearing 2 or 3 months down the road, they can show that they've now complied, that court dismisses the ticket every single time. And there is no doubt from my firsthand experience when I was working in code enforcement that we've got some professional property owners who find it better business to beat the rap once in a while than to actually manage their property properly. And I think that if we had this additional tool of holding these hearings when people want to appeal their ticket, their civil fine, doing that in-house, which we would have the ability to do if the city council were to adopt 40U, that would really put some teeth into it, because I think that our own in-house hearing officer would tend to be very cooperative on a first offense and really try to work with people, but would also very quickly come to identify the people that are in all the time and send a clear message that after you've got that first bite at the apple, if you continue to violate, you're going to pay the fines. And I think it would be more than self-funding in terms of the fines that would be collected. And I think it would give, whether you're talking building department, board of health, whatever department it is, would really give, I think, their inspectors more teeth on the penalty side for when we do have to deal with that small percentage of property owners or business owners that are just not conducting themselves responsibly here in the city.
I would ask you to consider that. And I did forward that to Attorney Gilday. He's working on what the law department sent to me, so we'll see if we can
push that. So if we could try to advance that, I think that would be something that the council proactively could do that would really help support our code enforcement people. Thank you, councilors.
Thank you.
Point of information, Mr. Chair, if I could. When I was the town attorney in the town of Randolph, neighboring community, they did adopt 40U, and it was an utter failure. I think the intent of Mass General Law is to give the municipality teeth as a mechanism to try to do quality of life issues. But and again, Randolph and Brockton are distinct and separate communities, but the same issues are the same issues. The Board of Health over there would issue these fines, and people just wouldn't pay them. At the end of the day, they would accumulate and accumulate and accumulate, and then the town would have to write it off, because you're not going to take someone's house over a quality of life issue. So I think we could probably tweak it, but that was just point of information that it did not work in Randolph.
Well, and I think, Council, we'd be more than happy to share with the Council that our law office has already started doing some homework and due diligence on it. And there, I believe, Lawrence and Quincy, are those the two? Eileen, do you recall? Lawrence, Chelsea?
Chelsea's the good one.
Lawrence and Chelsea, that we've already been in communication with and taking a good, hard look at how they're doing it, trying to learn from their experience. Also looking at part of this decision, we'd be making a software purchase, that we would have to buy a software management system to manage these tickets and hearing dates, et cetera. So there's no doubt that we're taking on some responsibility, but I think that we can look at it being effectively done in 2 or 3 other cities that are similar to Brockton. And, you know, certainly that could all be part of the due diligence with the council.
Thank you.
We're more than happy to work with you on looking at all aspects of 40U.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, don't sit down. I waited till you got there.
Did I mention how nice it is to have you back, Councilor Monahan?
Yes, sir.
I meant to mention that. I meant to mention that in my opening remarks.
You're not under oath, obviously. Yeah.
Thank you for visiting me. Anyway. Yes, getting back to when you were actually in code enforcement, I would be on the phone with you a lot, and when we did get some violations, it would go to the housing court, they'd fine them you would have gotten a fine for $300, and they slapped it down to like $50, and they could care less. And just going with see, click, and fix, which has really worked well, as far as, especially in Ward 2, where we have a lot of vacant properties and lots, and we've been advertising it on Facebook. People are starting to use that now and getting it out there, so I think the more people know about that, it'll be better for the city, and I take advantage of that situation.
I do routinely put some of my C-Click fixes in anonymously. You have an option when you do each report to either have it go in under your username or have it go in anonymously, and I do put some in anonymously once in a while just so my own independent check to make sure that I can see us responding to these. And I got to tell you, they're doing a great job responding to these. They really are.
Oh, yeah. They clean them up quick, and I've had numerous people. I said, try using that. I will call for some, but they use it, and it's being done quickly.
It's convenient. It's 24/7.
Oh, yeah. Easy. But the question I would have is going back a couple of years, Council Farwell's pictures are of garages and violations on that. Now, when I first got on the council, we had an officer dedicated to doing that. I didn't know, maybe some issues here and there, but he seemed to be on that problem that Council Farwell was talking about. We always had somebody on that dealing with those issues. And I know the chief has mentioned now that since we lost that position, there was a way that the police department was going to handle that.
So I'm going to let the chief and the lieutenant answer the police questions, but I'll tell you that both Sergeant Schliemann and Lieutenant LeGrice both spend a significant portion of their time working with code enforcement. So
okay.
Sergeant Schliemann was designated by the chief to be the liaison with the code enforcement agencies. So I'm not going to answer operational questions for the chief and the lieutenant. I'll allow them to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
You want Lieutenant LeGrice up to answer that?
Or? Yeah, that's fine, yeah.
Good evening.
Good evening. So you have
Schliemann.
So you guys have basically taken over for that position, working mostly with the garage issues and things like that.
Sergeant Schliemann is handling all the residential properties in the city, complaints that come in from homeowners and stuff about abandoned cars and vehicles. The Detective Bureau, which I oversee, we now also have the added responsibility of handling all the licenses in the cities, both liquor licenses, restaurants, auto dealerships, and repair licenses. Repair licenses, to give you an idea, I believe we have about 165 of them that have been issued in the city of Brockton, okay? We have roughly 20 detectives that go out systematically, will inspect these places. Since June, Councilor Farwell, we have gone out and inspected approximately 50 places. The reason we've gone to these 50 places to get across to the council is the hindrances that we run up against when we go to do these inspections. Out of the 50 that we did, 21 of those had no restrictions on their license. Out of the 29 that had restrictions, some had 3 cars in the garage, but no hours of operation. Some had hours of operations and no limit on cars. You mentioned 530 North Montello Street. Yes, one location up there is entitled to 5 cars. But if you read what you have issued, you gave license to 530 A, B, and C. Another one has 18 cars, another one has 12 cars, and the place off of Montello Street, not including the abandoned lot, which doesn't come with theirs, I don't know off the top of my head what they have for cars. So yes, 530 Montello Street has 5 cars, but if you count them all up and add them all together with no restrictions on where they're allowed to park, they were parking cars on East Main Street. I went up there one morning, 6 a.m. I towed 7 cars off of East Main Street that were either dismantled, left out there by the auto body shop. I just towed them for being abandoned and dismantled, okay? What we need the ability to do is to go onto these lots, not under the 72-hour notice, because then they jockey cars around and we don't get the message across, just like we do by going to the housing court and having them reduce costs or just dismiss the fine because they've become into compliance. These license agents, and I'm not talking every officer in the city, these license agents that we appoint to go out and do this stuff should have the authority to say, you know, your license says you're entitled to 5 cars. You have 8 cars on your lot. Send me 3 wreckers. When these establishments have to pay to get their customers' cars back, okay, the message is going to go out quick, all right? These are the reasons that I would like to see both 40U and to get under one board in the city of Brockton that we answer to, namely probably the License Commission, okay? Because that way there we can go in, we can bring these things in and start towing these cars. They know who the license agents are. We have roughly 20 of them. To make sure that the restrictions that you folks ask for get transferred to their actual license. When we go in, and I have some here, okay, that just, I had the officers go out, and I'll give you, you know, here's one here at, 753 Belmont Street, okay? They're allowed 8 cars in the garage. No hours of operation, nothing that tells us. I went to Mr. V's, okay? I've addressed the issue across the street. I tagged every one of those cars with a 72-hour notice. Unfortunately, due to situation beyond my control, I haven't got back there yet. I'm just returning to work, and I'm going to follow up on that. Every one of those cars, I guarantee you, are going to be towed in a short period of time.
Mr. Chairman, could I just have a point of information, if I could?
If it's a point of information.
But just a point of information, does anyone know the ordinance that requires 72 hours notice before you can take action? I can't find that.
What?
I may have missed it. I cannot find in the ordinance where if you go on a piece of property and they have more vehicles than they're allowed, that you have to give them 72 hours to clean that up.
I don't know the ordinance off the top of my head, but we have certificates printed by the city of Brockton with the ordinance on it, and we put them on every car, giving the owner 72 hours notice to remove the car, or we will come remove it.
You're talking two different things.
So you're telling...
Abandoned vehicles.
Yes.
Abandoned vehicles.
Are you saying that the restrictions right. that we put on here are not getting onto the licenses?
Unless you're not putting restrictions on licenses.
I mean, every time that... Now, these could possibly be older licenses that are just being renewed. Is this what the problem is? Because every time they come before us for a license, it's almost like a standard that hours of operation, they have to be this. So many cars, no this, no that. I mean, every time we do a... license here, there are restrictions that everybody puts, every counselor has put on. So
some licenses, counselor, some licenses have hours of operations, number of vehicles allowed on the property, not to park cars on the public street.
Okay.
Okay. Which I assume you issued. Okay.
So I would say that's probably something we have to add because I don't think anything said park cars on a street or things like that.
Well,
so we might
at some point, somebody must have put it on at least one license because I've seen it before.
Okay.
Okay. The issue comes with us is if these are not put on here, what do we enforce?
Right.
You know, if you've got 47 cars jammed on your lot and the lot is supposed to be, the parking space is 9 foot by 20 foot. It's very easy to calculate how many cars you're allowed on a lot, okay? But it's jam-packed and you've issued a license, but don't put these requirements on here. What are we going to enforce? What are we going to tow?
So I would say that if you want to get to us the restrictions that you need us to put on these garage licenses so that you can do your job.
Exactly. And what I'm saying is if we switch that to the License Commission, what we do at the License Commission is when we have new and used car dealerships come in, they have to come in with a plot plan. They have to come with a plan that shows how many cars, how many spaces are allowed. I go out personally and inspect that location, okay? I attend those meetings every single month. We go over, we make sure, we make adjustments on the number of cars that they're allowed. That doesn't happen at the city council level. We've never been invited here. We don't come, these are issued. We issued licenses on Elliott Street, which have been a problem since they were issued. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody went out there. There is no parking outside the building. So this is where they were parking at the entrance going into Porter's Pass and over there. These need to be inspected prior to the issue of a license so that we know we're giving it to a place that can accommodate the job that they want to do.
So we have normally, a lot of times, we'll come back and it'll be read by Tony, the clerk, about, you know, we had no problems, the fire department. So we need to add you onto that list of you having no problems with us issuing that license or any restrictions you might have that you have to see put on to the restrictions that we make.
The changes that I would suggest are simple, that being one, Councilor Monahan.
Mm-hmm.
The other ones are, as I said earlier, the ability to go on a licensed establishment. I'm not talking about unlicensed because we have a city ordinance that covers that. On a licensed establishment where we grant the license and you agree to 20 cars or 30 cars, whatever it is, and you're over that limit, we can call and tow those cars. That gets a message across. It's not a lot of paperwork. It sends a message that because they're going to have to pay to get these cars back for their customers. And I'm sorry, but that's how, unfortunately, how people learn sometimes is by hitting the pocketbook. And again, I agree with the mayor. We have gone out to these places. We have spoken to them. We have told Mr. V's down there at Tremont, Maine, okay, you're over the limit. We're coming back. We're coming back. I personally have been there three times. The third time there is when I tagged every car in the lot. And then, unfortunately, like I said, we will be going back next week. But it has taken longer than I expected. That was 6 weeks ago I was there.
So would that need to be in the form of an ordinance or just a license commission ruling?
Well, I think that if it switches to license commission, just like we do in liquor licenses, they put stipulations on those licenses, on restaurants and things like that, and they're allowed to make rules and regulations. I think it probably circumvents the ordinance part of it because it would be part of their license.
Yeah, so I think we should probably get together with our council, Mark Gilday or something, and you maybe come together and see what you can come up with some what you need.
And honestly, everything is then centralized. You know, I know the council's busy. I just think that it makes much more sense from my standpoint to move forward with these violations by doing that.
Okay.
And by doing that also, I can almost guarantee that these hours of operations, those types of things are going to, now it goes from you folks to the clerk's office. The clerk's office issues it. You know, there's a disconnect there. You know, this here, it goes to license commission,
right,
and boom, those orders and requirements would be coming out on the license.
All right, and we need your recommendations, then.
Yes.
Things would go pretty well. All right, well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you, Councilor Barnes.
Actually, I can drop. Thank you.
You're all set. Anybody else? Then, Councilor Fine, just as a point of information, it would take an ordinance change for those licenses to be issued by the License Commission, which we could do. But I also, in my 11 years, there's been no license that's gone through here that hasn't had how many cars they could have and hours in my 11 years. We've
right, and I think you,
yes,
what he's, what,
and
what
it's
he's saying
is not getting
that
transferred to the actual license.
It's not getting through.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Councilor Farwell. Oh, yeah. Sorry, Councilor Beauregard.
Hello, thank you. This evening, we've been discussing, let's say, the overflow of cars in various service stations and auto repair. But many of our constituents are really concerned with the way the neighborhoods look. The houses are not abandoned. People are living there. Yet lawns aren't mowed, and there's trash in the, you know, in the front lawn and the side lawns out onto the street. There's old boats that no one can probably ever, you know, float on in a lake or river. And that's what a lot of them have expressed a concern about. They highlight what they've seen in other communities where people get fined. So I'm wondering where you are with something like that.
I think that would be probably, yeah, for Mr. Tattaglia from the Board,
okay,
of Health, I believe.
All right. Thank you.
We're fortunate to have both Tattaglias here tonight. We're going to have the younger one come up and answer this one.
Oh.
Who came out first?
Okay. This is maybe for Mr. Casseri, I'm not sure. I don't know if this would be for you or Mr. Casseri, but I think it's probably for you.
Good evening, councilors.
Good evening.
Thank you.
I'm sorry, could you give me that question again? Council?
Okay, I'm sorry. Just so people realize, I've worked with the Board of Health on many concerns, and they've come through, and it's been terrific. But a lot of these people do not complain directly in sight a particular building. But what they see throughout the community is overgrown grass, trash, buildings that aren't maintained. Again, the boats, you know, that they're not using, in a lot of instances, an old camper trailer in people's yards and a neighborhood. And it's certainly, they've mentioned more than one constituent over the past few months that other communities they've gone to or different states they've lived in, the town had some sort of enforcement and fines. Now, I realize that these departments that have to address these concerns are not large, but it just seems that if we turn around and make the city look more attractive with people maintaining their own properties, I mean, we're not even talking abandoned, that we could move forward in enhancing the community.
Well, Councilor, your predecessor did submit an ordinance.
Yes, I remember.
And on boats, mm-hmm. trailers, tag-along, semi-trailers, and it died in committee. So I don't know what the council wants to do on that. I cannot cite a person for having a boat in his yard, even if it sits there, as long as that boat is in operable shape. I know there's one on East Avenue that we're working with the law department to get rid of. I mean, it's basically a pile of wood, but I still want to cover our tracks as far as taking that boat off the property. As far as grass, we have no ordinance on that, but we have been citing people in both abandoned properties with either the banks or the owner of record, and we also have been citing properties that are occupied as far as the grass is concerned. We're kind of stretching that a little bit because there is no ordinance or maintenance as far as a person's yard is concerned, but we do cite them for that. If you have any properties that you want taken care of, you can put it through C-Click Fix, or you can call our office direct.
Thank you, Mr. Tartaglia.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
You all set, Councilor? Thank you. Anyone else before Councilor Falwell makes his motion?
As far as that 72 hours, I think I know it applies to the motor vehicles that are in residential properties. They have 72 hours to get rid of either a junk car or more than one unregistered car. I think that's where the 72 hours comes from.
Thank you. Actually, Lieutenant LeGrace, could you forward to us a copy of, you said you have it with what you leave, if you could forward that to us so we can see what you're leaving. Thank you. Councilor Falwell.
Mr. Chairman, colleagues, I think there's a lot more we can do on this. I would like to see the outcome of the issues that I presented tonight with the pictures. So I'd like to move that this be tabled until a FinCom meeting in November, 3 months.
I want to rephrase that, and you'd like to motion to postpone it.
Postpone until a Finance Committee meeting in November.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded to postpone to the first Finance Committee meeting in November.
Yes.
Motion has been made and seconded. All those in favor? All those opposed? This is postponed to the first meeting, Finance meeting in November.
Thank you, Councilors.
Thank you. Item number 13.
Resolved that the Mayor, Police Chief, Fire Chief, City Solicitor, Board of Health Director, and any other relative city employees appear before the Finance Committee to discuss the recent actions taken by the city to vacate Tent City on privately owned property. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor, John Crowley, Police Chief, Michael Williams, Fire Chief, Louis Tartaglia, Jr., Board of Health Director, James Casseri, Superintendent of Buildings, and Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Councilors, this is my resolve. First of all, thank you for being here tonight, invited guests. Really, the intent of the resolve, I do want to applaud the efforts of those that that helped that day. I'm not sure if the city councilor, I can only speak for myself, but I did receive a call later that morning from then Chief of Staff, Mr. Buckley, informing that the action had already happened or was in the process of happening. Really, the intent of this resolve And it kind of echoes the sentiments of Councilor Azak and I when we filed the resolve last year relative to the homeless issue. And again, very few people choose to be homeless. It's really typically happens by circumstance. But I think the basis of this resolve specifically is for me to ask as an elected official why public resources were utilized vis-a-vis the city on private property. I know that the response, I suspect, is going to be public safety and health issues, and I can understand that. Propane tanks, there was prior fires there, propane tanks, hypodermic needles, I understand that as well. But let me be very frank and very clear. I own residence here in the city of Brockton. If some homeless person decided to squat in my backyard, put up a tent, and have a mini tent city in my own backyard, I couldn't have the city of Brockton vacate those people. I'd have to go to Brockton District Court, I'd have to file a trespass order, I'd have to go through the judicial process, spend my own time, my own money. So I'm not finger pointing, and I do want to thank the solicitor's office. Attorney Aileen Bartlett had called me a few times. I'm on vacation this week, but I do appreciate her efforts. But I think what I need to report back to my constituents, because I've gotten this, and I don't know if anybody else has, is first of all, it's been there for 30 plus years. Why was it done? Was there a plan in place? Was the city council involved? No, we weren't, and for whatever reason. But I think at the end of the day, I want to know a couple things. How many city employees were involved? How much regular overtime was spent on this? Were there any injuries of city employees undertaken on private property? And are we going to be reimbursed by CSX, which is the private entity? Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
So, Council, let me, I'll try to make general overarching comments, and then all the various department heads are here to give you specifics. So let me jump ahead 1 second, and then I'll go back to the beginning and walk you through the whole operation. But CSX up front agreed to reimburse the city for all expenses incurred. An invoice has been generated and sent. So through communications back and forth during the days leading up to the cleanup of the property, there was communication back and forth between our law office and CSX, and in that communication, they agreed that they would reimburse for the cleanup expenses. Now, I'll walk you up to how we got there, because you're right, Counselor. There have been a group of homeless people living on the CSX property for decades. There's no question about that. When I did outside code enforcement, I was out there a few times. And at the end of the day, you're right. CSX is a private property owner, and they are responsible. And I'll get to the point in the process where the city did issue a notice to abate a nuisance to CSX, and that was what really brought them to the table, I believe, and got their cooperation in finally accepting some responsibility for that property. Because I'll tell you, my 2 years of doing outside code enforcement, I chased them the whole 2 years and never got a whole lot out of them. They're based out of Jacksonville, Florida. The bureaucracy is bigger than the federal government, it seems like. They were a very difficult entity to deal with, and until we sent a very strong message, then all of a sudden, we could get the right people on the phone, the right people on email, and get some responses. But let me start answering your questions. I'll try to do them in chronological order. Yeah, there's been a homeless population out in that CSX rail yards for decades. Over the last couple of years, during my time as mayor, we've seen significant changes in the nature of that encampment and the amount of people in that encampment and the illegal activity going on that property. There's no question in my mind, and now this is going to be my personal opinion, that the opiate addiction crisis has a lot to do with it. If there is one overwhelming common denominator amongst the majority of the people that have been staying out there, it's heroin addiction. And that's new in the last couple of years. That wasn't the case 5 or 10 years ago. And when I have lengthy conversations with our first responders who are out there all the time, and I think to those concerns you listed, Counselor, we have to add the safety of our own police, fire, and EMS personnel that we were repeatedly sending out there responding to calls, and in my opinion, in the police chief's opinion, and the fire chief's opinion, had reached the point where our own personnel were at risk every time they had to respond to a call out there. And that was a key factor in my decision to finally take action. Over the last couple of years, the population out there has grown substantially. They have encroached more on the borders of the property. They were having a much greater impact on property owners and residents and businesses that immediately surround that area. The police department and I have been out for a couple of meetings with the condo owners on Crescent Street across from the BAT station, who are pleading for help because they're finding needles in their parking lot, encountering people in the middle of the night. We heard from a nurse who was nervous to walk to her car at 5 o'clock in the morning by herself because she was running into people that were using their parking area to use drugs or do other activities that are spilling out over from inside the CSX property. Banner Systems, a company that's been there for decades and has lived with the situation bordering their property for decades, was at the breaking point, sent us some very pointed correspondence that led to the police chief, the fire chief, myself, and a couple of others going out and meeting with him at his business to hear about the impacts it was having on him and how he was for the first time considering leaving Brockton because he could not tolerate the negative impacts he was getting on a daily basis, including his employees and family members being assaulted in his own parking lot by people that were living in the woods out behind his property. So there's that aspect of the growing population. Then there's the aspect, and I confirmed a lot of this with longtime homeless advocates. For years, it was a place where some chronically homeless people stayed, and we all acknowledge that. What it had become now was not just a place where homeless people stayed, but where people were coming and going at all hours of the days and the night for the purposes of conducting illegal activity out on that property outside the eye of the city. We had constant reports of responding to overdoses out there, assaults and batteries, rapes, drug dealing. It was really had become the wild, wild west out there. And I would encourage you to speak to some of the families that I spoke to on Mulberry Street and Elliott Street that described prostitutes coming off that property and performing sex acts in cars parked in front of their houses with their kids there, with people parking their cars to go on and off that property to buy and sell drugs. It was really had reached a breaking point with the surrounding neighborhoods. And then pull that together with the string of fires that were occurring, that were arson, that I'll let Chief Williams address. But the breaking point for me, and I won't put words in his mouth, I'll let Chief Williams address it, was after a string of several fires, one of which one of these people tried to burn down Banner Systems, tried to set his building on fire. But after a string of arson fires, they were out there on, I don't remember the date, but I remember it very clearly. They're out there on a Friday night for the second time. There had been a significant fire about 4 or 5 o'clock in the afternoon. And I got a text at 11 o'clock that night from Chief Williams, who was out on that property himself with his firefighters, expressing to me in a text that we needed to do something, that not only were the people living on that property at imminent risk, but also he felt as though his firefighters were being placed in harm's way by being asked to repeatedly respond to fires under adverse conditions out there. No easy access to water, heavy underbrush, people all over the place, dirty needles everywhere, latrines full of open sewage everywhere, and propane tanks, of which on that one night they seized about 20 propane tanks that were in the immediate vicinity of that fire. I didn't sleep well that Friday night, and on Saturday morning I began a series of conversations with the police chief, the fire chief, and a few of our other department heads that led to me calling an emergency meeting that Monday morning in which we brought all of the department heads and law enforcement people in. We also invited in our social service people from the city, Corin Capiello from my office, Lieutenant Linehan from the police department, who does a lot of work in that population, and we even had Father Bills at the table. And on this particular operation, even Father Bills joined us in supporting what we did because they knew chronic homeless people who wouldn't stay out there anymore because they were concerned for their own safety. So it really just reached a critical point, Counselor, where both public health, because of the open human feces, just I won't get into graphic detail, but trust me, we'll send you some photos if you'd like to see them. Just really horrible. Hundreds of dirty needles, just the living conditions, the illegal activity, and the immediate threat to public safety, both to the people there and to our first responders, I think put us in a position where we had to act. But I think that what Lieutenant Linehan will describe to you and what Chief Williams will describe to you was a very measured, compassionate approach. We took 1 week leading up to the day that we actually went to clean the property, where we had social workers trying to connect people with services out there. We had homeless advocates that knew some of the people out there. We had advocates from the Champion Plan, from Lieutenant Linehan, community policing. We worked as best we could with the folks who were actually staying out there overnight to help people relocate or connect with services before we came in to clean up the property. But there's no question in my mind that because of the health and safety of the people there, the health and safety of our first responders, the fact that it had become a mecca for illegal activity, the dramatic negative impact it was having on both residents and businesses in the surrounding area, that we were compelled to act, we were authorized to act, we issued an order to abate a nuisance, that led to CSX coming to the table voluntarily and working with us, and us insisting that CSX start taking some responsibility for their property. So that's my overview, but I think that Lieutenant Linehan and Chief Williams and Chief Crowley and others can shed light on some of your specific questions. But I do know the DPW did issue an invoice for the total cost of the cleanup.
And thank you for that summary. I think it was educational. My one question was the City Council president ever invited to go to that meeting? And the reason being is, and I can speak for myself, but we got the call from Mr. Buckley, which was good. It was after the fact. But I'll tell you, I got a lot of calls that day from people, and I couldn't answer them, and it wasn't a good feeling. So I was just wondering that if you had
followed. Well, I think the call went out. The call went out to the councilors. I think about an hour after the operation had begun. I think that, I don't know, in retrospect, I guess we could have invited. It was an emergency meeting of department heads and public safety officials. It wasn't a legislative. I called everybody in to say, here's the situation. Let's put all the heads together. Tell me what we need to do. And it arrived at what I thought was a very appropriate, measured response that looked out for the interests of the people there. I don't think there's an active role for the City Council in that type of meeting.
I think it's
operational.
Right. You could do what you want, but I'm just saying for an informational pieces, I thought it would have been helpful. But really, the crux of this is to find out, and I think you did educate me, and I want to speak to the solicitor's office, but I think you educated me relative to the reason, the rationale, the fact that we are going to be reimbursed. But from a legal lease, I just had a few questions I wanted to ask.
No, well, everyone's here to answer those questions for you,
Counselor.
Yeah, I
appreciate that as well. Thank you.
You all set, or who else? Do you have anybody else?
For the solicitor's office. Yeah, I just had a couple questions. Attorney Bartlett, good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for being here tonight. Thank you.
City Solicitor.
In terms of, and I think the mayor did a good job explaining the need, the desire, the purpose, the intent, and it would be echoed and sentimented by the department heads, specifically police and fire. I mean, that's their expertise. But being a lawyer, I have some pause relative to, first of all, being able to make sure that we do get reimbursed from an entity that's outside of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts if they're based in Jacksonville, number one. Number two, had prior notice been given to CSX in the form that the mayor just articulated to us, that was the triggering impact, and I suspect it would have been given for many, many years if that was the case. And then more importantly, when city employees go on private land, be it police, fire, board of health, city councils, the mayor, you, there is always the chance of liability on behalf of the city. Mm-hmm. The city owns that person. So I guess my question would be is, and hopefully the answer is no one was injured and no one got hurt, and that would be great. But I'm just trying to figure out, number one, if an invoice goes out to CSX based in the state of Florida, number one, we don't have a note or a promissory guarantee. Mm-hmm. They don't make reps or warranties, I suspect. So what I'm trying to figure out, number one, is what's the dollar amount? Mm-hmm. How are we securing that dollar amount other than putting a municipal lien on the property? And then more importantly, the hard dollar amount and reassurances going forward that we're not going to have to continue to do this, because the vacation of that location of the homeless people, they're going somewhere. And ultimately, again, by circumstance, a lot of them will probably find their way back there, right? So I guess I'm just trying to find out twofold. Number one, dollar amount, how we're securing that dollar amount to make sure we get reimbursed. And then more importantly, what's the guarantee from the private property owner that they're going to secure their property going forward?
Mm-hmm. Well, as the mayor mentioned, we did act pursuant to the newest nuisance ordinance. We were simultaneously in communication with the contacts from CSX. They indicated that they wanted to work with the city, that they were very much just as interested as we are in clearing out the property. To protect the city's right to go in and clear it out ourselves, we did send an order to abate a nuisance, which under the ordinance, if they don't act within 5 days, the city has a right to go in and abate the nuisance ourselves. In that same section, any costs incurred by the city constitutes lien on the property. So practically that's our backup. But so far, CSX has complied, has held up their part of the bargain and complied. They're still within the 30 days to pay the bill. I did send it to them and it's been officially billed to them.
How much is that, attorney? How much is that bill?
Mm-hmm. 1 second. And Commissioner.
Okay. Good evening, Larry.
Good evening. I can give you a brief breakdown of what the questions you asked. There was about 28 personnel out there between fire, police, DPW, mostly DPW,
everybody.
Health inspectors. It was the whole city. So with that being said, we went through, out of there, we took 27 tons of debris. And that came to like $3,500. The charges for the equipment charges, which we had a lot of equipment in there. We had backhoes, front end loaders, skid steers. We had to bring in, like the mayor said, I don't want to get into it, but we had to bring our vac truck in there because it was two big piles of human waste that we had to suck up through that. So that was 14,000. I'm just giving you round numbers. There's a little. And then the labor, which was hardly any overtime at all. We did come in early, and contractually we have to pay our guys 3 hours when they come in. So give or take, maybe 5 hours overtime, this whole job. So the whole job costs $35,107.
Great.
And that's the bill that was issued to CSX.
Was anybody injured out of those 28 people?
Not as far as DPW. Louie, is one of your health inspectors, is he okay? Was he all right? I think one of his health inspectors got, when he was picking up a needle.
One person got hurt?
Just one person, yeah,
Thank
God. Other than that, no, everything is fine.
Okay. And then, so my last question is relative to, thank you very much, Commissioner, securing that lien on the 35 grand, and then also how we can get a guarantee from them that going forward, they're going to make their property abide by any and all current laws.
Right, and as far as holding up their end of the bargain, they did agree to clear the trees, which I believe they've done.
Is that why they're in CONCOM? They're going to conservation?
I believe so.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
And just to point out, just something that I should mention, trespass statute under Mass State law with regard to railroads is very strong. And I imagine it has to do something with the fact that railroads can't always control their properties because they're all over the country. So that, you know, for instance, police officers can arrest any trespassers without a warrant. So that's just something to mention. It's very strong. So I think certainly the city's authority to go in and clear it was even if we hadn't used the nuisance ordinance, but that was better to secure the costs incurred.
Okay. Awesome. You answered everything. Thank you very, very much. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you. I'm actually not too sure who would be the best to answer this, but maybe Mr. Tartaglia, has CSX, have they ever been in violation of paying any taxes or any tax trouble or anything or any other bills to the city ever? Does anybody know that? No? Okay. Okay, because I'm just concerned about the relationship, because even in your opening statement, that you know that area's been in that kind of condition, but escalating the last few years. But you know, since I was a child, I remember you know that area being that, and them just being, I guess, silently compliant with allowing it to grow to the. This now that we had to do that and people are being assaulted, and that's of great concern to me. So I guess I want some surety that this newfound relationship or something with them, that we can guarantee that they're going to actually hold up to the end of the bargain. I know that you've mentioned that things have been going well now, but had it gone better before, we would not be at this particular space right now. So that's just my concern with them going forward, and then having this outstanding $35,000 kind of bill out there when, you know, from what I can see, they've not been in any kind of professional relationship with the city.
No, but I think they haven't had a chance to pay the bill yet. The invoice just went recently. So,
I know that's just like an added piece to the relationship. Like I said, this has been growing for this many years, decades.
Yeah.
And for it to reach this fever pitch where people are being hurt and innocent people are being assaulted, that is of great concern to me.
Yeah, it's always been a great concern to me, too. And I think it just things, a culmination of a series of events that it reached the breaking point where I didn't feel the city could allow it to continue any further.
Now, I had another question, too. So you mentioned the cast of folks that came to the meeting, and, you know, you said there was like a weeks-long kind of planning session.
Yeah, and there are others that can explain it in more detail than me, but...
Okay, but no, just something that you said. So you said that you had the social service folks come forward, Ms. Capiello,
right.
Some other folks from some of the other agencies. So,
right. Father Bills provided us, or they should say provided us, they provided a couple of their own outreach workers who would have relationships with a lot of the people out there who would, they would know them and vice versa, and they were helpful. And Lieutenant Linehan also did a lot of great work out there interacting with people that he came to know out there also. So every effort was made. We estimated that there were 75 to 80 people living out there. There were 16 encampments that had multiple encampments, you know, encampment being several structures, tents, et cetera. And at the, Lieutenant, the day we went out,
It started off 19,
yeah.
It went down to 9, and then 5 was encampments.
Yeah. So
could you...
Lieutenant Linehan did a lot of that outreach work.
Okay, but that's actually not my question.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's my question.
All right.
Okay, so I'll just finish my line of questioning. At any time, was the Executive Office of Health and Human Services contacted to have the state maybe come in? And this was something that I was asked right after that because, you know, we all got the call. And even, like you said, an hour into, you know, the whole evacuation. So when I got the call, I think from the paper, I thought immediately, you know, that the executive offices, that they should have been called in somehow or even set up like a satellite office or even use maybe the DCF office or one of these offices here to maybe triage some of these folks, because there is nothing that's stopping them, first of all, from scattering. And they did scatter, actually, right on Plymouth Street right there.
Yep.
There's a bunch of tents over there now, and I actually did see a fire in there one time.
No, and we've been, just so you know, Council, we've been to that
just
site.
Just let me finish, please. And triaging these folks in addition to what we're doing locally, but to have a bigger tent or a bigger eye on this, and maybe even you know, having these people evaluated. From what I understand, a lot of them aren't even from the Brockton area. So it may even be a situation where they might be able to go back to family members or go back where they came from.
So
was that even discussed?
So, Councilor, if you would indulge us and allow Lieutenant Linehan to answer your question, he will describe to you in great detail all of those efforts that took place.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
On the 20th, that emergency meeting was called. All the department heads came in and Main Spring with Father Bills, social workers, outreach workers, and ministry. The ministry outreach workers and Main Spring were asked to go out prior to us. They went out that day, the 20th. They encountered 19 of the many that do live there. There was 16 encampments, and I believe 4 or 5 of them were burnt out. So there was 21 total. They did the outreach. We thought that we would be going in there that Friday. There was a hang-up. That got rectified. We went out the following Monday. On the 21st, the fire department and police department went out to get all the propane tanks out, and whomever was out there to identify them, did a warrant check on them, and 2 people were subject to arrest. They were arrested. They were bailed out, and they continued on. On the 27th, we went out. We encountered only 9 people. Out of the 9 people, to join the Champion program because of the social work efforts and the efforts of the Champion plan. Two are relocated, and they were concerned that their services in Brockton wouldn't follow them to their hometown. So we made sure that their services followed them to the hometown, and they were relocated.
Excellent.
So we had five that were not, they were disgruntled with the move, but they did move. It was done with dignity, respect. Everything was offered to them. And the 31 years that I've been here in Brockton, I've never seen the city's arms so open and so giving, and five chose not to take it.
Okay.
So it was a very positive thing.
Okay. And are there patrols in there now to make sure that folks haven't kind of migrated
there
back?
There has been patrols while they were clearing the woods that they could take down. Right. There was, I believe, two arrests for trespassing, because the trespassing signs went up when CSX bought into the plan. They put those signs up, which gave us the authority to go in. Okay. Those signs were up prior to the move out.
Okay, and I guess maybe this is something for...
They had private security patrolling the property because they actually reported an overdose a couple weeks afterwards.
Subsequent to the clearing out, or they had patrols while the folks were living there?
I don't know up until what date. I know we had an overdose death out there that they reported from their security.
Over 2 weeks ago when they were clearing the property, one of the security officers was going into the area where the machines were going to come in and take out all the timber, and they found a gentleman that overdosed and passed away.
Okay, I understand. All right, thank you. I guess I'm just trying to figure out, too, is there anything that we have that will, going forward, make CSX responsible for not allowing this to happen again, and even in the agreement or anything? I mean, now that it's done, you know, I'm just very concerned that under the cloak of darkness, folks might come back. And
that signage allows us to go in and arrest anybody that's trespassing on that property.
And I understand that, but my concern too is if you go in there and then someone else is dead, or you go in there because there's a fire, you know, just what is there to prevent this from happening again? Any kind of friendly agreement or corporate partnership with CSX to have them be responsible going forward?
So in the conversations that took place in those days leading up to, it was that concern was expressed by the city repeatedly to CSX, primarily through the law office, that the city expected CSX to accept the responsibility of making sure that their property was secure and not re-inhabited by all the same people all over again.
And then they found someone dead in there 2 weeks after.
That person wasn't living out there. That person appeared to have gone out there to use the drugs. It's 31 acres, Counselor. Right? Unfortunately, we had four overdose deaths last month. We have 100 last year. It's part of the problem. So I think that we've, to every extent we legally can, have put them on notice that they are responsible to prevent their property from being reoccupied and to maintain it in a responsible manner. That did include the posting of the no trespassing signs at the beginning, which the police department felt was critical, so that if they did respond to a call out there, they would have a legal right to remove whoever they found, which previously they had not been able to do that, because you can't arrest somebody for trespassing if they haven't been told not to trespass first. So I think that is, it's complicated. There's no easy answers, Counselor. It's complicated. And we don't think for a second that we have solved the homeless problem by dispersing a group of homeless people. But I do think that we addressed the immediate concerns for health and safety and welfare of residents of this city by taking the action that was necessary to be taken.
All right, thank you. Thank you all very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Mayor, if I could just address a couple things. I, too, have the same concern that Council Sullivan brought up in terms of it seems that this body always gets notified after the fact, and then we're stuck with answering questions from residents, figuring out exactly what's going on. And I don't see a a reason why. I know we talk about, you know, anytime somebody brings up an issue with an employee, we're told it's, you know, it's a personal matter, we can't discuss it. We bring up an issue with the police, it's high security, we can't discuss it. We bring up some sort of an issue that has to do with the school department, it's school department, we can't discuss it. You know, honestly, I have an issue with that. You were elected just like we were elected. We have a certain responsibility just like you have the same responsibility.
Right.
It's not, you don't have any more privileged information that I should have, because we are accountable, especially the four of us that are actually at large in this community, we are accountable to the entire city, and people do want to know what's going on from a city standpoint. So the fact that we are kept in the dark every time something is going on, because if a phone call came to me and said, hey, listen, we're thinking about clearing out Tent City, to me it's good. You know, let's clear up Tent City. You know, there's no, I served in the military. I think I'm actually able to keep a few secrets. You know, I think I actually had a top secret rating when I was in the Navy. So I think I can keep some secrets. But the fact is that...
It'll put you in the minority among elected officials, Counselor.
No, I'm not. I know I'm in the minority. Yeah, I can tell I'm in the minority. But the fact is that sometimes when these things are happening, it doesn't take a great deal of an effort from the administration standpoint just to kind of communicate across the lines, in this sense, just to inform us prior to, so that we're not sitting here making up stories to tell people as to why something happened when
So let me answer that in a couple levels. Let me give you a broader general answer, then I'll answer specifically to this issue at CSX property. I think overview, I think that there's the legislative branch and there's the executive branch, and the executive branch operates city government on a day-to-day basis, and the legislative branch has very clear responsibilities around overseeing budget, policy, ordinances, etc. I think that there's a difference between operational and legislative, and so I don't think it's practical to try to bring 11 other people into every decision we're making operationally with the city. I think we certainly, it's incumbent upon us to be fully forthcoming with you and answer any questions you have. And I think we always try to do that. In this particular case, some of the guidance that we were given in these meetings, and I think some of this was from people that that we reached out to that had dealt with this issue of dispersing homeless populations in cities, was they felt it was important that it be done quietly, that there not be a lot of advance notice, that it not get out into the press or anything like that, that it makes it much more complicated to accomplish something like that if you're going to have outside people somehow getting involved. I can't really quantify it exactly, but that it was important that, you know, we wanted this to be done right. We wanted it to be successful. We wanted it to be respectful of the people that were there, that we made a great effort to assist every person that was out there. And, you know, those individuals have rights also. They have HIPAA law protections and civil rights, just like all the rest of us do. So I think that we were just trying to make good decisions, do this the right way, do it compassionately, but eliminate the risk to the public. So, you know, could we have sent something out the day before on an advisory basis to say, hey, this is going to happen tomorrow? Maybe we could have done that. But I think the meetings that took place were strictly operational. It was law enforcement, department heads, law office, dealing with the legalities and trying to work with the agencies that were going to deliver the services. I'll tell you that Father Bills and our social service people asked us repeatedly not to say anything publicly prior to the day we were going out there, because they felt their best chance of working effectively with the folks out there was to be able to do it outside of the public
eye. Mr. Mayor, I wasn't saying send out a press release saying what you're going to do. I'm talking about making a phone call to the 11 of us to say, look, we are putting together a plan to clean up this property that's been a nuisance in this city. That's all I'm saying.
My experience is that gets it in the newspaper.
Well, it got into the newspaper because as soon as it happened, we got a call from the newspaper that we had to figure out what to say and make up stories.
But I think we made an effort to make sure you were notified prior to the newspaper getting a notice.
I think we got it after the fact. At least that's how I got it.
I will guarantee you that the phone call went out before we released the statement. We were very meticulous to do that.
Well, it might have been, but what I'm saying, I'm going to come back to this thing again and say, you know what? Again, you did go through the whole thing about who's in what branch, what side of government. We're all in this government together. If we're going to make this city
And we all have our roles, Council.
I understand that.
But sometimes we need to stay in our lanes.
I understand that, but if we're going to make this city a little bit better, I think we need to be informed of when these things are taking place, even if it just means doing some advocacy, you know, advocacy for the city as well, and defending the city in some instances where if you get caught, you know, by surprise, there's not much you can actually do other than do what normal human being reaction would do.
I really view this as a public safety issue, Councilor. So, you know, with all due respect, I think public safety issues are primarily addressed by the police chief and the fire chief, and I follow their guidance. They're our public safety officials, and
I think public safety is addressed by everybody. We all have to be on the same page here to address public safety in this city. It's not just addressed by the police and the fire. Public safety is a matter that involves every single citizen, every single person in this community. But let me go on to my next point, which I think it was touched a little bit here in the sense that CSX is now being put on notice that they're going to do what they can to make sure that they maintain that property. But at the same time, we are using city resources to kind of ticket people in their properties or arrest people in their properties. So we're still using city resources to basically do their bidding in the sense. And what I'd like to see...
I think it turns the other way around, Councilor. We've been expending a lot of city resources on that CSX property for a long time, sending firefighters and police officers and EMS people out there constantly at great risk to them.
I got you. I talked to the chief about that, and I know exactly what you're doing.
Taxpayers have been paying for. The cleanup operation is being reimbursed by CSX, and it is not costing the taxpayers.
We put a stop to the bleeding of the taxpayers' money out there. My concern, Mr. Mayor, is the upkeep. That's what concerns me, because we put all those resources in, and we put the brave men and women of our city's fire and police department to clean that up, and the city as well. But the upkeep is the concern that I have, so that we, in 3 months, 4 months, we don't go back to the same place that we were 6 months ago. And that's the concern that I have. And I think we need to be a little more forceful with this company to say, look, it's private property. You have a duty to keep your property. If you have to hire police detail on a regular basis, then you hire police detail on a regular basis to do that, and you do what every single private business does. You know, so, we should not be subsidizing their business
is assure you that if you were in the room on the speakerphone when we had the conference call with CSX, I made it explicitly clear in no uncertain terms that the city would hold them responsible for the future security of that property. I couldn't have made it any more clear. And I think the message was heard.
Now, the other issue that we're facing is the situation at Perkins Park.
Yep.
I was just down there Friday afternoon to do a cable program that we do every week, and there's at least 20 homeless folks sitting on the ledge.
Yep.
Which does not make a pretty picture of the city that we're trying to promote.
So what are we doing about that? Yeah. So Perkins Park is
this is way off point from the intent, but it's the folks that I talked to.
I don't understand that, Mr. Chairman.
I'll tell you that we are addressing it on a daily basis. We have regular meetings with the parks, police, social service workers. We sent DPW in there about a month ago to dramatically increase the nighttime lighting. We're walking a fine line between violating people's constitutional rights and trying to make it safe. And it's a tight wire act, Counselor. I made the decision that making it much brighter at night didn't violate anybody's rights. You're not supposed to be in the park after dusk. We're sending the police in there regularly in the evening to clean out the park after dusk. Is there a huge problem with loitering and drug use in that park? Absolutely. Are we cleaning that park up several times a week? Absolutely. Are we having conversations ongoing right now as to how to make that wall and that area around there less comfortable to sit on? And we're working on that right now. So I think we are keenly aware of the situation there. Our homelessness task force meets again sometime this week. I know that's on their agenda, and they've been looking, trying to think outside the box in creative ways to improve that situation on that block. And it's a challenge. That's drawing public resources. We're in there on overdose calls all the time. I looked at the July overdose data this morning, and I think we responded to over a dozen overdoses there in 1 month. So we are proactively going to take what steps we can to make it less and less desirable to camp out there. We are enforcing the dawn to dusk guidelines of the park department regarding all of our passive parks. We don't have the right to go in there in the daylight and just kick people out for no reason. It's public property. We do have police officers going in there several times every day and night, though. We're trying to address one of the big contributing factors, Counselor, to the trash and some of the aggregating of more people in there is people who come in primarily from out of town on weekends and feed people in the park. And I'm dead set against these outside feeding programs, and we're working with our homeless task force right now, again, to try to be compassionate, to connect some of these do-gooders from out of town that sleep better at night because they hand out a few box lunches in Brockton on a Saturday afternoon instead of taking responsibility for some of their residents who are now our homeless population. But we're working proactively with our social people and our churches to try to connect some of these outside, primarily church groups, with a couple of the downtown churches to be able to direct this feeding to an indoor site that a couple of the churches are volunteering to make available so that we can still allow people to bring food to people in need, but get away from the these outside feeding programs, which are unpermitted. They require a permit. They're doing it without a permit. And that's part of what's contributing to the problem there. We are picking up on a Monday morning 50, 60 needles on a Monday morning discarded in that park. Doesn't concern anyone more than it does me. And we are looking at, the bottom line is, and our homeless task force will say this, we've got to address the underlying issues. Just moving folks around, just trying to do law enforcement, it doesn't solve anything in the long run. We've got to do a better job of connecting services with folks who are struggling with mental illness, who are struggling with substance abuse addiction, and try to get those folks connected to the services that will help them. Part of the real frustrating part, Counselor, is no matter how hard we try, there's a nucleus of this homeless population that just refuses the help.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Counselor Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Actually, what I'd like to do is defer to my colleague, Counselor Sullivan, and ask that this be brought back to Finance Committee with more information on some other, whether to see, first of all, if the city is paid by CSX, and get a report on what CSX is doing to address this, and where we're going with the individuals that have been displaced. So
through you, Mr. Chair, I'd be happy to do that, Ward 5 Councilor. Do you suspect that it should just be a postponement of 1 month to the FinCom in September, or do you want to see it October?
I think we should do October to see where this is going to go, and we're going to get a change in temperature and environment, and I'm curious to see
Thank
how
you,
that affects us.
Thank you, Counselor. I'll honor that request.
Thank you.
So I would like to note that around code enforcement, there was just the topic before this one, city agencies routinely, on almost a daily basis, enter private property, clean it up and secure it, and lien the property. I think that's what we want us to be doing. When properties are allowed to become a threat and a detriment to the neighborhood that they're surrounding them, I think it's incumbent upon us to take action. We have an ordinance that allows us to do it, and we do it on a basis that the taxpayers eventually get their money back. It's a revolving fund, and those properties are liened, and when the property changes hands, the lien gets paid off, the money flows back in. This, you know, kind of philosophically was just a bigger version of the same type of operation of going in. We often have to go in with the police with these vacant houses and get people that are squatting in there out. We got to board them on the first floor to secure them. We got to clean the property. I mean, this was a cleanup operation very similar to stuff we do every week, but obviously on a much larger scale.
Mr. Chair, I don't necessarily agree with that, Mr. Mayor, because as I
you're
said...
You're on the floor right now, Councilor.
That's okay.
You'll have a chance when
well,
you...
I thought she referred it to me to make my motion, yeah. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, thank
but
you,
we're
Mr.
not
Chair.
There yet. Yeah. Councilor Lally.
I just wanted to, you know, to say that I appreciated, you know, the clearing out of Tent City, and but I just had some concerns about... Or just a little, just to build off what Councilor Rodriguez had mentioned earlier, I respect that, you know, as the executive branch, you're the one handling day to day, you're making the decisions and things like that. But just as sort of a almost a professional curse, just a heads up to us so we can explain to our constituents, even if you call us, you know, a day ahead or send something out, I'm not gonna tell anyone, I'm not gonna put it on Facebook until whatever it's about has been taken care of. But it would make talking to people who wanna know, you know, calling, wanna know what's up, it doesn't look good for us ourselves or for the city council for the city of Brockton if the legislative wing of the government doesn't know what's going on.
Right. And you were notified at the time, but we'll agree to work harder at that.
Yeah.
I'm accepting the criticism constructively, and you know, maybe we could have told you the day before. Our social service people were really imploring us to not release any information until they had a chance to try to get everyone out of there, and we were actually going in to clean up the property, and that was on Monday morning.
And that is a tough call on your part. So
but you know, I'll try to think of ways and. Maybe we can train the new chief of staff better than the old chief of staff.
Oh.
Well, hey, when all else fails, why throw it on the guy who's on his way out the door?
But thank you for...
it's the chief of staff's fault. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
But thank you for taking care of that property. And I just wanted to raise the concern that I've been informed... by several people that some of these displaced homeless are moving into Chukas Park in that area.
And we have been addressing several of the hot spots, as the councilor brought up. Plymouth Street, we've been in there with the Salvation Army, relocated several of the people that went there are back out. I will tell you that there's one long-term chronically homeless person in there who has someone with them, built a shelter in there. I'm not going to say his name. But all the people in the neighborhood know him, and they don't have any problem with him being there. He doesn't bother anybody. So I'm not necessarily looking to pick on people that aren't causing any problems to us. We have enough people that are causing problems. The area that you're describing over by Tukas, we just met subsequent to the operation at CSX. About a week later, we were out to meet with the owners of Yano Companies, who own that CVS, ShopRite, whatever the supermarket is, Plaza. And we were there to hear their concerns, along with the people across the street. Lieutenant Linehan did some great work getting a couple of the people that were hanging around there to voluntarily relocate. And, you know, we're trying to do the voluntary outreach as the first manner. So we knew... I mean, you know, we knew that dispersing this group would cause some people to pop up in other places, and we would have to be prepared to address them, and we're addressing them on a case-by-case basis as compassionately and effectively as we can.
Right. Thank you.
Before I go back to Councilor Sullivan, did you have one question before you?
I did, Mr. Chairman.
On this?
Yes, it is on this particular cleanup issue. We have some residents here in the gallery, and they have brought this to my attention. So this actually might be for Mr. Rowley. The leveling of the area and the removal of all of the debris and the dirt and all of those things, as it was once a viable, I assume, a railroad, was that debris tested for?
Yeah. So I'll give you part of the answer. DEP was consulted before we went in there, and the commissioner will explain to you that we followed their prescribed method of just scraping across the, above the top and not going down and disturbing anything. But okay. Larry, do you want to address how that was done?
And I guess as you come.
But that issue was discussed as part of the preparation.
Okay, and the cost for that testing, is that included in this $35,000?
We did have the DEP on site with us when we were there, and they didn't deem anything hazardous there. Uh-huh. The only thing we had to really do is stay away from, there's a little river out there, so we stayed. We didn't uproot anything. Whatever was there, we just took out. We didn't do any digging there at all.
Okay.
Or excavating.
Okay, thank you.
Just the camps we took down, and that was it.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Chairman, I had a follow-up for Attorney Bartlett. Two quick questions. And thanks again for coming tonight. In terms of the 80 people that were living there, and I know there was 28 city employees, one person was injured. It sounds like it was a slight injury. Were any of those 80 people, any of those homeless personnel claiming injury or indeed injured where the city would be held liable you're aware of?
That I'm aware of.
Okay.
No.
And then more importantly, and I was actually kind of stupefied by the fact that a private property didn't have no trespass signs posted. Are there other properties in this? Should it be a practice that the city solicitor's office notifies a big commercial?
Well, it would help, but like I mentioned here, and I'll just cite the statute, it's Chapter 160, Section 218. It's railroad property. So, I mean, the signs help, but they don't need notice if you read
right,
that statute.
Right, because it's held to a higher standard under the general law.
Right, because it's a railroad for that reason. So, I mean, certainly we could, it certainly helps to have the no trespass because they can't claim they just didn't know.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to make a motion to postpone this to the first FinCom in October.
Second. Motion made and seconded to postpone to the first FinCom in October. Councilor?
Yes.
In October. All those in favor? All those opposed? Postpone till October. Item number 14.
Resolved to have members of the staff of the Brockton 21st Century Corp, along with the Mayor Carpenter, inform the City Council on current projects taking place to promote further economic development, new business, maintaining business, and other outstanding issues being faced by this organization. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Rob May, Director of Planning, Robert Jenkins, Executive Director, Brockton Redevelopment Authority, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director, Brockton 21st Century Corp, John Marion, Chairperson, Brockton 21st Century Corp, Matthew Osborne, Treasurer, Brockton 21st Century Corp, Chris Cooney, President, Metro South Chamber of Commerce, Susan Joss, Brockton Neighborhood Health Center, Sheila Sullivan Jadam, Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, and Ronald Lido, Brockton Area Transit.
Councilors, I did receive a notification from Mr. Lido and Mr. Cooney that they could not make it tonight. They had previous engagements. Yes. Okay. Good evening, Ms. Scalarani. Councilor Beauregard, this is your...
Yes, I filed this, and we all know that last month, at the last minute, I was told that you could not attend. Now, I've been proactive since then because I believe that my frustration, I'm not alone. I feel like I'm up here representing the constituents and many of my colleagues with where this is going with Brockton 21st Century Corp. So actually, I'm going to have Rob May come up. And the biggest reason I'm having Rob May come up here as Director of Planning is simply because he lives in Brockton. And I believe one of the problems that we're seeing, I do want to point out that Sheila Sullivan Jardim of Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board informed me she was not around this week on vacation, was that maybe one of the reasons that this is not working like it should is because a lot of the board members don't have a vested interest. They don't live in this city. Now, it's not to say that they don't run successful operations. We all know that the tremendous asset that Brockton Neighborhood Health Center is and Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, and for that matter, the award-winning Metro South Chamber of Commerce. But it seems that when they can go home at night and they don't have to worry about the repercussions or the lack of action and the lack of, how would I say it, new businesses coming into the community. And I mean, I read this report twice, okay? And I don't want a trophy for it. I mean, it was my decision, because one of the frustrations is we never receive enough information of what is transpiring. We don't know how often you have meetings. We don't receive minutes from the meetings. And again, this is not all directed at you, Rob May, but if we don't get businesses in Brockton, then we can't afford to buy the things we need for the city of Brockton, whether that's a fire engine or repairs on school buildings, or our big one too is paving of the streets. So you benefit from all those if you live in this community. So that's why I really wanted to highlight this. I have been speaking at length with CEO Chris Cooney about where we can go with this, because he's been involved with it for, I'd say, over 15 years now. And it just seems that we're not moving in the right direction. I mean, when I read this and I highlighted all these various situations, and you know, they talked about, for example, the commuter rail. The commuter rail is not our only source of public transportation in this city. And we have the MBTA come to the Montello commuter rail station, and we have the Brockton Area Transit Authority that's really successful. And, you know, we seem to always be excuse-driven with certain things. I do want to highlight that, too. Yesterday, I took the Ashmont bus and, you know, looked out the window, and I saw a lot of older buildings in other communities that are not vacant. They have businesses in them. Oh, they're not massive in scope. They're barbershops sometimes, a pizza place, insurance company, etc. But the statement was made that maybe some of our buildings are so antiquated that we can't meet the needs of a business. Well, in Mattapan, they're doing it. In Dorchester, they're doing it. In Randolph, they're doing it. Avon, they're doing it. Avon and Randolph are way smaller. And Mattapan and Dorchester, we can relate more to their situation. As I went through this whole phase, okay, and I talked about, and this is, like I said, what's really triggered this, is I don't like the fact that the MIT students that were supposedly putting this together have this impression of Brockton, okay? We are not an undereducated group of residents. And most of us do have a command of the English language, and many speak several languages and are educated professionals. And none of that was highlighted. I mean, it was continuously emphasized that we have lower education attainment. You saw our superintendent earlier. When she was here in June for the budget, she could turn around and say that over 89% of the students that were graduating from Brockton High were going on to higher education. So this was, first of all, like I said, I found it frustrating, and I'm wondering if this is a detriment when people, you know, have access to reading this, and they say, oh my, if this is Brockton, why would I want to be here? When in fact, in so many instances, the opposite is true. And I believe that one of the ways that we can begin to change all this is by having a board that is composed of individuals that live in Brockton and run a business in Brockton and or both, because it just seems to be we need to be focusing on that. I mean, I am a strong proponent of expanding our health care. We have phenomenal hospitals in this city, and we serve all the other communities surrounding us. And that's where I believe part of the problem is. We serve other communities that have individuals that are less educated than many of us. We serve communities that have individuals that don't have a command of the English language. And it just makes it look like it's just us that really, quite frankly, we come across as, you know, uneducated morons. And I that's very frustrating. And, I, you know, like I said, I pinpointed different things. Now, we talked about the challenges to the creative growth economy. And several times it was highlighted that the city was part of all this. And, you know, usually they mean when the city, in this case government, they mean the mayor's office. And now we had an organization called Cultural Arts and Economic Development, again, a group of individuals that volunteered their time to progress our cultural, you know, background and art background. And then, all of a sudden, we don't have it anymore because the mayor's office, you know, didn't want to send anyone out to represent the mayor's office. Since then, though, I'd like to emphasize, and I know I'm not alone in this, that people feel that there are many volunteers that have come up and, as the expression goes, stepped up to the plate and highlighted not only our fabulous history here, but all the remarkable talent. I mean, every time you turn around, students from our institutions of education are winning awards that are recognized both in Massachusetts and nationally. So that's, I just felt that this was very frustrating. And I know it seems like I'm beating you up. I just feel that you live here. Do you want everyone to think that, well, you live in a place where we're not educated, we don't have a command of the English language, and for example, here, it talks about investments in healthcare workforce development. And it says here, and I wrote, why will we have trouble drawing people in that are educated? When I ask people where they live that work at Signature Healthcare Broughton Hospital, Good Samaritan Hospital for that matter. So those are, like I said, I felt that this was done to almost make us come across like, we're just, no help. And right here, I wrote down, and I saw this, a regional healthcare collaborative. We're ready to work on these things. And as my colleague, Councillor Rodriguez, highlighted, that maybe we're not included enough, the city councils here. We have a very aggressive, hardworking group of city councils this time around. And it's not that we haven't had in the past, but maybe this is part of what's missing. And now, we highlighted, that we have all these low-paying jobs and the individuals don't move forward. And that's not the case at all. I went to the Gateway College graduation at Massasoit. Remarkable what was transpiring. These individuals were taking off to Simmons and other institutions. And, I'll highlight one of the reasons that it got to me. Where am I? I'm on page 45 here. And it says, workforce development initiatives. Okay. And it says here, phase one of this project identified Broughton as a community with significant employment challenges, persistently high unemployment, residents concentrated in low-skilled, low-wage jobs, and limited advanced opportunities with existing careers. Okay, then we go to the next sentence here, and I had to highlight this part because it just got to me so much too. And it highlights here, communities within the region, a large foreign-born population, many of whom may have limited English proficiency, and a significant number of single-parent households, which may have increased challenges in coordinating employment. And Massasoit was recognized for their choice programs throughout the Commonwealth. I'm in a meeting in Pittsfield, and they're going on about how great that program is. That helps single parents and low-income individuals. And I feel that a lot of people were deprived of the phenomenal assets we have in this community. And I'm bummed. That's my term, bummed, that this is going out reflecting our community. And this is not our community, right? We have a great deal of history, we have a great deal of education, and, I saw something here about getting, software company, and then I mentioned also that maybe we've got to look at getting businesses in here. And I'm tired of the empty storefront, so this grew too. And it just seems that maybe the communication with the city council would further expand an opportunity for some sort of success with getting more businesses in Broughton, big, small, and otherwise. And I highlighted here where some things have already been done and address education gap through coding boot camp. That successful program is going on with Broughton High and the Broughton Public Library System right now. And I just feel that that's what part of the problem was. Because city council was not, approached. So much came out of here that is not a demonstration of our city. So I really hope that we're going to get some students back and we'll redo this report to really and truly reflect our city. No wonder we're not getting businesses in here if we don't have a command of the English language, and we lack encouragement in business incubation, when in fact the chamber has hosted repeatedly, SCORE and SEED and other entities. I went through this whole thing, and we've had these huge programs where we brought, the chamber brought to help minority-owned businesses, for example, where a couple of hundred people showed up earlier this year. And I just, none of that was brought up. And I don't believe that the students that helped put this together ever really heard any of this. And it says here, help newly established business grow and stabilize. I really want to see that happen. But if you're not out in the community, how is any of this going to happen? If you're not reaching out to the city councilors, and mind you, some of us are educated professionals whose first language is not English. And it just, like I said, I'm extremely frustrated. So I read this twice because I thought maybe, you know, had an attitude the first time I read it. And then I met with the director of Old Colony Planning Council because he also lives in Broughton and he actually lives on the east side. And we talked about how we've got to have to work to turn this around. In, you know, because I don't want everything to be negative, I will highlight that we're very excited about this gentleman, George, that is the TDI fellow, and he has demonstrated that he is out in the community. And we need more reports, we need more participation, and we need more business, because no one is asking any of my colleagues to raise their taxes. So that's, I mean, this is about the size of it. So I look at this as, because it wasn't done last month, is that we need to come back, and I'm going to say in a couple months here, with a proposal to turn this all around. Because I've only scratched the surface, and my colleagues have other concerns, and I'll defer to them. But that's what I'm going to ask to do this evening. Thank you.
Well deserved.
Just as a point of information, I think my colleague was saying the report was not well written.
It's the information in it that's very distressing.
You don't have the floor anymore, Councilor.
But seriously, Mr. May, I think some of us did read that report, and we felt like the city was put in a negative light. And I think we need to, and maybe that wasn't the intent, and again, that just might be my perception, but I do think the city has a lot going for it. I think we have an exceptional school system and people come out, and we do have a workforce that can fulfill a lot of different jobs, and there is great potential for economic development. And I think Councilor Borgat has hit on the fact that as you take a senior leadership role on this urban renewal plan and the reports that are generated and the work that's done, that hopefully we will cooperate and collaborate with you, and we will, you know, portray the city in the light which I think it deserves.
Councilor, thank you. Unfortunately, a lot of we're not the authors of the report. It was a class by MIT. It's graduate student class. Most of the data is based on either a review of census information, or through a series of interviews and conversations and focus groups that the students have had. If you aren't keen on what they're saying about our educational levels, our language achievement, I would also suggest that you read the trend reports at a blueprintforbrockton.com. We've published three of them right now. We have an economic development trends report, and we have a population trends report. We should be producing the housing trends report shortly. But there's a series of statistics where we compare Brockton with other gateway communities and other similar style communities around us and with the state. And in some cases, we do have a lower level of high school graduates in the population of people over 21. The facts are the facts, and I'm sorry if some of them are not pleasant facts, but those are the cards that we're dealt. We have to improve that hand, and that's working with our school department to increase adult education. That's a critical need. Most workers in Brockton do work for lower paid industries. Those are facts, whether we like that or not. And our department, Planning and Economic Development, we're a staff of three people. Myself, a staff planner, junior planner, and an administrative assistant. we don't have the time or the money or the staff to be in every place that we would like to be in. Now, we have a relationship with B21 that we're trying to amend. It used to be in the past that the city would just, you know, write a check to B21 once a year. Mayor Carpenter and I have worked on that to say that if they are getting money from the city, there should be a scope of work that we expect them to be doing. And this is the first year that that's happened. So we meet twice a month where we review the scope, we review both B21, BRA, George from TDI, George Durante, pardon me, George, if you're listening, and myself and my staff, where we review the work of both B21 and the Campello Main Street manager so that we're getting our money's worth. So we've asked them to do several things, including, you know, documenting all the vacant storefronts, how much space there is available, what condition it's in, where, what kinds of businesses could use that. We want to work with, and we've asked them to work with the property owners to make sure that there are for lease signs in the windows of vacant properties, that they're listed with the multiple listing service, or there's two different companies that do commercial properties, which are LoopNet and CoStar. We've asked them to become much more involved in creating marketing materials. There should be a welcome brochure for people, for residents who move into our community. There should be something that we can give to you to say, okay, you're in this neighborhood, there's a hardware store around the corner, there's a grocery store over here, there's the dry cleaner and the daycare. There's people who don't know that there's a small skateboard park at Edgar's Playground. So we need a brochure that way. We also need to produce something that talks about the businesses. Why should you be locating in this area? And so there's demographic information that needs to be collected, or not collected, but it's put into a usable manner so that a business can look at this and say, okay, if I'm in this particular neighborhood, there's X number of customers around me, there's X number of dollars that could be spent. We know where, it's called retail gap analysis, so we know where certain activities are taking place and if there's enough money left over to start new businesses. We also need to be working to create a business accelerator and a business incubator. And that's part of the scope of work that we have with B21 this year. So we do have a plan. It's going to, hopefully we will, you know, be working on this or continue to work on this all this year. But we do have a strategy of moving us forward with the assets that we have.
Well, a final comment. I do understand that a lot of reports are statistics-driven. Mm-hmm. Obviously, a report coming from MIT students, some people, rightly or wrongly, will place more emphasis on it. But there are many, many people in this world, in this community, who don't have a high school diploma, and they're highly intelligent, and who probably don't make much money, but they could probably achieve great things. And I just want to make sure, I can't speak for my colleague, I just want to make sure that Brockton is not judged by statistics, but rather the character and the integrity of the people who live here and the capacity of the people who live here to achieve great things, because statistics can cut two ways. And
lies, damn lies, and statistics.
Yes, yeah, that's true. So that's my final comment. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I actually wanted to hear from Mr. Jenkins in terms of some of the BRA activities. But Mr. May, before Mr. Jenkins comes up,
yes,
and I'm glad Councilor Falwell brought that up in terms of the statistics that we use in this community. We all know that the Census Bureau is not really a friend of Brockton. Mm-hmm. We know that for a fact. If you sit down and think about it, and again, you don't have to be an MIT student or a Harvard grad to figure that stuff out, that the Census Bureau does not reflect the numbers from the city. Because if you look at Lowell, for instance, a community that's pretty much the same size as Brockton, has a much smaller school system, and yet they've got about 10,000 people more than we do, 10,000 more in population. So the census have not been a friend of Brockton. But yet what concerns me is that we keep quoting the census. Instead of knowing that the census have not done a decent job to help us out throughout these years, we keep quoting the census. Every single report that I see, according to the Census Bureau, you know, whereas we probably would be better served by quoting real numbers saying we do have the fourth largest school system in the state. Mm-hmm. That's a fact. Mm-hmm. It's not a census fact, but it's a real fact because we're counting number of students coming into our buildings.
Yeah.
Just like Lowell does in Boston and some of these other communities. So perhaps we should dwell a little less on the census numbers to proving our point, knowing that we can't really use them all that well, and focus on more tangible numbers that we can actually see. A lot of times these reports that you're reading, although it was done by MIT students from Boston, I am quite sure a vast number of people from this community were not touched by that research. They did not. I'll bet you the second language speakers that they refer on the report, a lot of these second language speakers might have a non-traditional high school diploma, meaning from their homeland or whatever they come from. That's not on that particular report. So sometimes I think we in this city tend to become our worst enemy in a sense. You know, we're not the biggest promoters of Brockton. I say it, I mean, I've gone places with members of the police department. They run a picture of the city that would petrify, that you would prefer to go to Baghdad before you come to Brockton, because that's sometimes the message that's painted. And if we're trying to promote this city to a level where other communities are promoted, I mean, I was in Boston not too long ago, and I saw one of the T-buses with a big sign on the side, something, something, come to Lowell for this, come to Lowell for that. This was a Boston bus, yet they were promoting Lowell. Mm-hmm. Where is the Brockton promotion at that level? I've seen the commercials that are done, but we're relying on commercials when in fact that we can do other things to promote this community. And we don't do a real good job in promoting Brockton. We are often, and I try to mention that to the mayor earlier on today, that we are by far the worst enemy that we actually, the worst enemies that Brockton has is us. You know, government officials, people in positions of power that could actually do a better job in promoting this community, but we don't do a very good job in promoting this community. And the reason why I asked Mr. Jenkins to come up is that, you know, you travel into Boston, for instance, and you see, you know, another skyscraper coming up, and it says another project of the Boston Redevelopment Authority. Projects being, you know, that pop up everywhere that basically say that. We don't happen to have that in the city of Brockton. And I want to know why. Why can't we have a development arm in the sense that somehow, and I know that we try to go after these small businesses, these small, you know, mom and pop types of businesses to move into our community. But, you know, not too long ago, GE came into Boston. Is it possible that if we were somehow on the same level with their development team in a way, I know that you're short-staffed and everything else, but you're not going to be long-staffed. If the mentality is we're short-staffed, there's nothing we can do because we're short-staffed, it's never going to be, or now we're long-staffed.
No. We make inroads. We make things work. We're talking with new businesses, talking with property owners on how to reposition their properties. We don't have the resources to be everywhere, but we are somewhere. And the case that we've created a new urban renewal district in downtown, that gives us the authority, and Robert the authority, to become much more involved in real estate development. And hopefully that this is the first of a couple of different urban renewal districts that we should be looking at. But I'll let Robert talk about
Yeah, I just wanted to know because, I mean, the guy in charge of the Boston Economic Development is a friend of mine, and yet he tells me, oh, we got this $1 million coming in, that $1 million coming in, this $1 million coming in. And I'm just saying, why can't Brockton get a percentage of some of those things that are coming in by just establishing these relationships with the with some of these other development organizations that exist in the state? If GE is going to come into Boston with I think they donated $23 million to the school department, I'm sure they could have, you know, well talked. Maybe they would have done a couple this way. You know, instead of putting in all their plants in Boston, maybe they could have put a subdivision in Brockton, you know, if it's well pitched. I'm just saying we have to think outside of the box because I think we're spending way too much time thinking about the little, you know, the little block instead of thinking outside of the block.
Agreed, and that's Counselor, why. And thank you this evening for coming this evening, inviting me this evening. And thank you for the question. I think just like the report that Councilor Beauregard had pointed out, the answer is pretty easy. And I've worked in Dorchester and Boston and for a nonprofit. The fact is, Councilor Rodriguez, they've always had a plan. They've had a urban renewal plan going back to the 60s. Unfortunately for us, we just developed our urban renewal plan that we just passed a month ago. And we're still working on it and got to get it past the state, who we're meeting with tomorrow.
Yes.
So this is the reason why we don't, or your redevelopment authority, didn't have the authority to do it. I mean, they were formed as a redevelopment authority. Matter of fact, we're one of the few redevelopment authorities left in the state that has the authority to go ahead and do development. Our issue is we never had a plan. And so now that we have a plan, there is activity that's going on specifically in the district, the urban renewal district that this council passed. Okay, so you gotta give us more than, you haven't had one since I've been here anyway, and I've been here since 2009. I don't know my predecessor, who we all know and remember, God rest his soul, but they started in 67, and he did a lot of good work. However, I don't recall when the city actually had an urban renewal plan, except for when it was formed in 67, under my predecessor, Steve Cruz. I don't think there has been one since. So with that said, Counselor, yes, we are looking to do development, especially in the district. You will be seeing it. Thanks to Councilor Farwell, as I talked to him, sent him emails on changes that we needed to have in order for the state to approve our urban renewal plan, which we hope when we speak with them tomorrow, that's a move in the right direction that'll be happening. And there is activity, and I know you don't see it, and you don't hear about it, because it is private development. And it may or may not come to fruition, but there are several things that are happening in the district that you'll be hearing from in the next couple of months. I'm sure of it. We have a plan. Give us time to work it. In regards to that document that Councilor Beauregard brought up, you all should be frustrated. But let's be realistic. It's not telling us anything we didn't know. Mm-hmm. It didn't tell us anything that we didn't know. All right? And yes, it's frustrating, and you're right. We are the worst promoters of ourselves. We don't promote ourselves. I've said that time and time again. Every time I come to a council meeting, my board, we're not good promoters of ourselves. You know? People come in, they ask what's going on in Brockton, and they don't know because nobody tells them. All they hear about is what's in the Enterprise. You know? They don't know the fact that we run a first-time home buyer program. That, yeah, you can get more bang for your buck here in the city of Brockton than you can anywhere else in the state, maybe with the exception of Chicopee or out west. You know? So we got our work cut out for us. That's it. I'll take on any questions.
Still your floor, Counselor.
No, I'm just saying that because to me it's very frustrating. It's very frustrating because I see this happening on a regular basis. Again, as Councilor Beauregard said, we're totally uninformed. We could be your biggest promoters and promote the various activities going on in the city, but by the time we get hold of some of this information, it happens right here at this podium. And a lot of times we can't really do much in terms of promoting anything or even making, you know, there's a lot of us that have contacts outside of the city that could be beneficial to helping push some of the agendas that we need to push outside of the city. I know that the mayor said earlier that it's the executive branch that has to do its thing, that we're supposed to be the lawmakers in the sense, but you know what? We're the people's voices. And we know a lot of people in the community. Sometimes some of those voices could be shared and those people could become the promoters of this city. Because it's sad where you spend a great deal of time listening to people, all you hear is the negativity because that's all that they hear. The very positive that comes around some of the issues that we're talking about, it doesn't come to us. So if it's not coming to me, the only thing I'm going to regurgitate is the negative, because that's all I heard. You know, because the positives are being kept somewhere, when in fact, if it's shared, a lot of us could do a lot to promote whatever efforts that we're putting together in this community. And yet, let's not sit here and make documents like that the Bible of the community, because it doesn't do justice to anybody in this community, because efforts like that, yeah, it might be true, because I'm saying it might be true, because it doesn't reflect this community. It doesn't reflect the total community. So if it doesn't reflect the total community, it's not true. It has some truth in it, but it's not a true report, you know, because it doesn't reflect the entire community. I wasn't asked to participate one way or the other, and I know, again, I'm one of these so-called, you know, I come from a home where, well, in my home, English is spoken as a first language, but my mother still speaks Creole at home, so, you know, but I wasn't consulted, I mean, I wasn't approached or I wasn't asked to participate or anything like this, where you might have had a different take on this thing. You know, we've got a lot of homes where English might not be the first language of the home, but it doesn't mean that those individuals are uneducated. They might be slightly undereducated when it comes to the command of the English language, but you've got folks that have degrees that come into our neighborhoods. It might not be the Brockton types, but it's actually something.
I think that report was targeted toward a specific, looking at specific industries that we were looking to bring into the city. But don't make that the Bible. That can't be, that's not, like you said, it's not a reflection of the city. It's a report that was done by graduate students from MIT. And quite honestly, human nature is to take the path of least resistance. They didn't go out and survey every individual in the city, or even half the individuals in the city. They took statistical information from 2010. And we know most of that information is, I won't say corrupt, but inaccurate at best. Question. So, I mean, it's a just...
But a lot of communities, a lot of progressive communities in this Commonwealth, would have taken that report, looked at it, and say, you know what, this does not reflect us, and right in the trash it went. Because it was something that was done by, you know, you said, MIT students, probably not even, you know, walking the neighborhoods or talking to people in the neighborhoods to get an idea of what's going on. So they did it based on some census numbers. So in reality, that actually hurts us a lot more than it actually helps us. Because if you're looking at, as she was saying, businesses to come down, if businesses are saying, you know, this is a totally uneducated community, why would I invest in this totally uneducated community? When in fact, almost 90% of the kids that graduated from our high school went on to college.
Exactly.
So we can't be that much of an uneducated community.
Let me say this. Most people, businesses that are looking to come into Brockton aren't looking at that document.
Thank God.
I can tell you that. That's not the document they pull up and say, let me look at this document and see if I want to come to Brockton.
The only person that's walking around with it is Anne.
Maybe. And the students at MIT who wrote it. So with that said, I mean, that's not the Bible.
You all set, Councilor?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Rajak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to keep this pretty brief. I don't know how many copies of that document around, but I would, just as my colleague said, trash them, because we went to a workshop where a few years ago I attended one of the workshops. I know you gentlemen have gone to them, where we tried to brainstorm and see what we could do to make the city better. And the number one thing, and I believe we may have been in the same group, Mr. Jenkins, was image, perception of the city. And there's no way we're going to make that better when people are reading things like that about us. First of all, about languages, I'm proud that I speak multiple languages, and there are people that would come in here because they want people to speak multiple languages. So being multilingual is an asset, just as my colleague said. So
I just feel like we need to do something, and we rely on you, gentlemen. You're doing a great job. I know, Mr. May, you do have a plan, and we look forward to seeing the fruition of this plan. I know some things don't happen overnight, but it's good to know that they are happening and they are moving along, and we rely on you to help us change the image of the city, because that's what we need to do. We need to have a positive image, and if there's anything we can do on our end, you need to let us know. We do have, you know, we're out in the community, we hear things, we talk to people, and as Councilor Rodriguez said, there, some of us have connections outside of the city that could help. So please get us at the table with you. And Mr. Gallerani, if you'd like, put my colleague, Councilor Beauregard, on your, I believe she would be an asset to B21. Put her on there.
The council president is on the board.
Oh, on the board, definitely. But maybe make sure that
we're...
Subcommittee.
Subcommittee, or just have her at the table, because we see some things in the community that can be an asset, that can make a difference. Thank you. Mr. May, sorry.
Mr. President, about reaching out, I think, you know, we are doing a much better than what has happened in years past. As we're doing the citywide comprehensive plan, we have a rather large steering committee that several of you have nominated or recommended people participate in. We are doing it in multi-languages. We currently have, our website is up. We're doing a visual reference survey. It's available in multiple languages. And if, you know, and I'm asking you if you could share this information with your constituents so that they can participate. There's going to be another series of meetings coming up this fall. We'll be getting that information out to you. I do it on Facebook and on the city's webpage. But we need all of us pulling together, and I agree wholeheartedly that you guys are, you know, you've came to a meeting. I thank you. I know several councilors came to meetings. It was really nice to see you participate.
Councilor Burns.
Thank you. I just have to say, for the folks at home that are listening, I don't want it to seem like the council is beating up on our economic development team.
They are.
Yeah, but no, I don't want it to seem that way, and that's why. That's why I'm going to come in with a little bit of a different perspective. I've known Mr. Jenkins since he first got over there when it was BBB. And, you know, watching him progress, and I've attended several of the meetings, the Brockton Housing Partnership, where we sit in a room with 20 bankers figuring out what to do with first-time home buyer money. There have been websites upon websites, new designs, all of these things. Home buying program, Nehemiah program, it just died out because nobody applied. And it was very difficult, and the frustration at that time was to figure out how to get the information to the people. The feedback was nobody reads the paper and everything, and the internet was still, Facebook was still in its infancy back then. So there was really no way to do that. And the effort in trying to get the right message is not something that, you know, this team has just now started to do since Mr. May has been here and Mr. Gallerini. That's not something that has happened. The frustration for everybody trying to help develop the city of Brockton is long-suffering. It is long-suffering. And we need to be very, very careful about kind of understanding what you said. The folly is on us and on previous administrations for not having a plan, for waiting until Rob May came in with Shane and Pam and those folks to come in and to finally figure out these things that have been going on for years and decades in other communities. If we're going to continue to compare our city to all of these other cities that are doing these things, we also need to realize and figure out what their foundation was. And if it was just as easy as having a plan, shame on us for not doing that. And Councilor Stewart used to say it all the time, and he's been referenced here a lot tonight. He used to say it all the time during budget season. Police department has a 20-something million dollar budget on the books. And for advertisement and marketing, $200,000. What are we protecting? What exactly are we protecting? So this is not just a new thing, and I mean, I was out of town, so I didn't get to read the report, but I'm going to read it, and I'm going to try to take everything that's been said here today and use it as I take a look at it. And granted, like Councilor Rodriguez said, we have to be very careful about the information that does go out, but if it's facts, it's facts. And if we're going to also employ, and I'm just going to say, if we're going to employ outside agencies or statistic agencies or reporters to do something, before it gets put out there, maybe there needs to be, I mean, I'm sure you guys, let me back up. Did you all read the report before we got it? Or did anybody read it to see if you maybe had the same, before it was published, to see if you had the same?
Met and went through it over at the Shaw Center.
Okay, and were the sentiments the same from the people in the room, like this is not okay?
I think the sentiment of the room, understand that the report was done by students that had 3 months.
3 months.
To do this report. The objective of this report was not to say, to pat us on the back. I never thought it was to say, this is what Brockton was doing good.
Okay.
Okay, the report was to identify economic development challenges. I think that's the basis of the report.
Okay.
Education is an issue, I think, in our community. The fact that we do have low technology jobs in our community is an issue. The other fact of the matter is that while we have one of the best high schools, a fourth, and this is, the state knows this, everybody knows this, you can talk to anyone. Our public school system, everybody knows, is top notch. But guess what? When they graduate from here, they go to secondary colleges, but they don't come back to Brockton.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's an issue. They do not come back here.
Mm-hmm.
At one time, it was the housing. There's a lot of different components as to why they don't come back, but they do not come back here.
Mm-hmm.
That's a challenge for us. Okay.
Well, I just
but understand once again, this report is. I think we're focusing too much on this report. I think this report is just one of another document that has some statistics that, quite honestly, it's not telling me. When we sat down at the Shaw Center, it wasn't telling me anything. Didn't tell me anything new. Didn't tell me how to solve anything. I mean, right. That's not what they do there.
Well, I want to thank you gentlemen and your respective teams for what you are trying to do and also recognizing, you know, some of the challenges and being willing to have that not hidden, but willing to work on that. So I do want to thank you all for doing that and thank you for going
just
forward.
Just one other point, because I know through Council Farwell, Council Sullivan, we talked. Tom, I'm glad to see Council Monahan back on his feet again. Council Rodriguez, like you said, Council Barnes, Council Beauregard, we've talked because we've known each other for decades. I have a relationship, and the BRA board has a relationship with this council, one that my board wants to maintain and wants you to participate, not just on the urban renewal plan, but on everything that the BRA does. You will be invited to the board meetings. It's up to you to come. They're always open, so you're always welcome to come to the BRA board meeting. First Wednesday of every month. Mm-hmm. Okay? Thank you.
What time?
3:30. As a matter of fact, we'll make sure that when our board minutes go out, that they go out, invitations go out to all council members.
Thank you.
What's
that, Councilor?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. Anyone else? Councilor, you have a motion?
I wanted to move.
Hold on, just a minute. Make it quick, Mr. May.
I do want to about sharing contacts. I do want to thank Councilor Rodriguez. He did share a contact with us. We worked with a business who was interested. Unfortunately, the first site didn't work out. The second site, we're still working on. But that's important. That's where these leads come from. So I did want to thank you for doing that. Sorry.
Thank you. Council Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair here. What I want to do is ask that we vote to file this resolve favorably with the inclusion that we have everyone back, let's say, in October for a Finance Committee meeting to review where we are with everything.
So you want to make a motion to postpone this till October?
Yes.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone until the first meeting in October. All those in favor? All those opposed? Postpone until the first meeting in October.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Moment of personal privilege, if I may.
You may.
Two of our esteemed colleagues, one's a former mayor, one's a former school committee member, celebrated birthdays this week. One on the 8th, one Farwell, and Dennis Ianeri on the 13th.
Both the former school committee members.
This is true. I think the mayor trumps the school committee, but he's the dean, so we'll have to figure that one out.
Happy birthday to both of you.
Thank you.
Are you all set, Councilor Sullivan?
I am, thank you.
Okay. Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to take a moment of personal privilege to highlight the real success successful event that took place Saturday with the basketball tournament and all the volunteers that came out there and just had this fabulous barbecue. These kids just got together. It was so organized, so well done, and the attendance was phenomenal. So I'd like to commend that, because let's all remember that was done by volunteers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Farwell.
Very briefly, a moment of personal privilege.
Okay.
I'd like to thank John Hayes from the Edgar Park Neighborhood Association and Jacob Tagger, who's here, for their work, their coordination, their planning for the recent event held down at the park in Councilor Monahan's ward. I did my best to represent Councilor Monahan during the day and the evening, and seriously, it was so refreshing to see all the kids and the parents. Didn't matter where you were from, didn't matter your background, everybody had a great time, everybody had pizza, and for those who were down there, it was really an event. So great to be in Ward 2 all the time.
Thank you.
And you are in Ward 2 all the time.
Anyone else? Just a reminder, we're still on summer schedule. We have council next Monday evening. We're adjourned.